following is a live presentation of CBC Sports.
The Stanley Cup is Canada's spring ritual, but so far the hopes of the North have gone south. The Windy City blew out the Flames in four. Next chance belonged to Toronto, but in a war of experience and attrition, the Leafs keeled over in six.
Broken up, gets in front, Leafs scores! Leafs scores for St. Louis!
We turn to Vancouver, which couldn't contain a citizen of its fair city. Three have been denied. So now for Canada, it's up to the Montreal Canadiens, who find themselves in a bit of a mess, down 3-2 with Game 6 this afternoon at the Molson Centre in Montreal. Or could it be the upstarts from southern Manitoba? The number one team in the NHL is thinking right now. They're thinking because of a sensational young goaltender named Nikolai Habibulin. Canadian fans, this could be your day. Don't worry, be happy. Ontario, Quebec, and Atlantic Canada, you're bound for the Molson Centre in Montreal. The Rangers and the Canadiens game 6. Windsor and Western Canada, you'll convene at the arena in Winnipeg, where it's the Jets against mighty Detroit in game 6 of their series. There's Mark Messier, captain of the New York Rangers. How often do we tell the story of his leadership? It's the veterans against the second youngest team in the NHL at the Molson Centre, and of course, the frenzy in Manitoba. I'd like to take credit for that be happy line, but that's coming out of Winnipeg, where they've got all kinds of puns for their feisty netminder who's given Detroit all they can ponder. And Mike Vernon, incidentally, goes for the Red Wings in the game. So two great stories to tell here for the Canadian clubs, and one other as Pittsburgh tries to move on. Five have already advanced to the round of eight. Three have a chance to do that this afternoon. Good day, I'm Ron McLean. There's Dick Irvin and Greg Millen in Montreal. Gentlemen, you can set up the Rangers and the Habs.
Well, there were some lineup changes or a couple of key ones expected for Montreal, but really it didn't happen, Greg.
Well, that's right. If Mario Tremblay had his way, Kovalenko would not play this hockey game. He's been brutal the whole series, but Rychinski's knee is just not ready yet, so he has to keep him in.
They talk about the experience the Rangers have over the Canadiens. One of their most experienced performers, Kevin Lowe, missed the game two nights ago in New York. He's back, we think.
Well, we think he is. He took warm-up. He told me before the game his wrist feels a lot better, so expect Kevin Lowe to play. Kurpatsov, on the other hand, has been bailing out on Colin Campbell. He will not play. Barry Richter's up for the minors. Look for the Rangers to go with seven defense here this afternoon.
And Barry's no relation to Mike Gron, who the Canadiens have to solve if they're going to continue this series.
Especially on the power play, right, fellas? You can feel the tension at the Molson Centre. The mood should be markedly different in Winnipeg. Let's listen, and then you'll hear from Don Whitman and Brian Hayden.
You think they might be seeing some ghosts from 2 years ago?
Well, I think they're seeing Artur Zerbe flashbacks, that's for sure. I'll tell you what, Detroit has dominated this series territorially, statistically, but here we are in Game 6, 3-2 Red Wings. The Jets played a great game, home game, game number 3. If they can put that same kind of effort, they can force a seventh game, and you never know what can happen in that situation. More than anything, Detroit has to find a way to solve Habibulin.
Keith Primo has been stymied, particularly in Game 5.
Well, there's no question Primo's been frustrated, but it's not like he's not getting the chances. He just has not been able to finish, and most players will tell you that they can be satisfied with their play as long as they continue to get their opportunities.
And if the Winnipeg Jets, Ron, are going to take this to a seventh game on Tuesday, Nikolai Habibulin will have to again say yet to Red Wing shooters.
Thank you, Don. Thank you, Brian. It's magic in Winnipeg and, of course, excitement in Montreal. As best we can, we'll tell you the tale of two cities throughout the day today. We'll be weaving the story in the intermission, sending you to the venues that you're not with at the moment. And then at the end, whichever game's done first, we'll go to the other game. So we'll tell the whole story as the afternoon moves along. It'll be great for Montreal and Winnipeg. We'll face it off next.
It's time to play.
Throw up the rim to win!
At Tim Hortons, where everything's always fresh.
Even the prizes.
Win!
One of 15 1997 Ford Escort LX sedans or wagons.
Roll up the rim to win.
5,000!
Raleigh mountain bikes. Or over 8 million Tim Hortons prizes.
Roll up the rim to win!
Drink the coffee first, people.
Roll up the rim to win.
They're rolling off the line.
Wow!
Hi, I'm Art Drysdale, and this is the Garden Claw. Using spades, forks, or cultivators can be back-breaking. The Garden Claw has a patented design that virtually eliminates bending and lifting. Turn the handles and the steel tines corkscrew down into all soils, even clay. It's perfect for mixing in peat and fertilizer, and it's ideal for working around plants and shrubs. The Garden Claw is backed by a 100% guarantee.
Look for this display.
Available at Canadian Tire, Sears, Kmart, and Zellers.
Still a couple of moments before they drop the puck at the arena in Winnipeg, so welcome back to the broadcast center in Toronto. The Jets and the Red Wings set to do battle. I'm with Kelly Rudy, and Kelly, do you think they're panicking at all in the Detroit dressing room, or at least do you think the media and the fans will be starting to whisper about these Red Wings?
I hope they're not panicking. Wayne Gretzky, that is, once told
you don't
me.
Know him very yeah, well.
He told me the first round is the hardest to survive because of all the pressure, and I think for a little bit Detroit is feeling that.
The challenge of a number one goalie, I mean, when you're going in on Habib Boulin now, you may be trying to make the perfect play, or do you think they just have enough firepower that they shouldn't be concerned with that?
I hope they're not concerned with that. The way they've played the last four games has been remarkable, and only because of Habib Boulin, the Winnipeg is still in it.
Do you get the feeling you haven't seen the best from Winnipeg? The Jets beat them once during the regular season. They beat them twice in this series, but it's all Nikolai in the two victories. You almost feel that Winnipeg's due to break out and have a big game themselves.
Well, if that's the case, then they certainly need bigger performances from their star players. And I only see Winnipeg doing well if Detroit has an all-out collapse and Winnipeg gets great performances, not only from Habib Boulin, but role players and talented players.
We've spoken about Winnipeg's Russians being inspired by Larionov and Fedosov. Keith Tkachuk will wear the C, and that's a bit of a sore spot
it's
with him.
Time. Of course.
Yeah. I expect that he's a guy. Manson scored the winner, albeit a little bit of a break, but he came through for them in the last game. Now Tkachuk, I think some responsibility will fall on his shoulders.
Right. Well, that was only a managerial thing that took that captaincy away from Tkachuk, and I think that disrespect intended towards Chris King, but everybody has to look on Winnipeg to Tkachuk for leadership, Manson as well, Janny, and Jamnov.
Chris King, of course, gone with the MCL problem. Scott Oak's been a busy fellow going back and forth between Detroit and St. Louis, and now he's in Winnipeg. So, Scott, how about a preview from you?
You know, Ron, the Red Wings think of the Winnipeg Arena as the most unfriendly building in the NHL, and why wouldn't they? The sea of white here with its deafening noise can throw even a powerful squad like the Wings off their game. The most inhospitable of all the Jets is Nikolai Habib Boulin. You can't say enough about his goaltending, but we're well-paid professionals, so what do you say we give it our best shot? From ecstasy to agony, back to Habby. Winnipeg fans thought they'd bid farewell to their team in Game 4. But then in Game 5, hockey's version of the Cold War. Nikolai Habib Boulin had already established himself as a quality NHL goaltender. But at the Joe, he was an iron curtain. Apparently, someone forgot to tell Habib Boulin about the Wings' Stanley Cup mission. Conventional hockey wisdom says a goaltender can only play this way so long, and sooner or later the floodgates will open. But Habib Boulin never faltered. One after another, the Wings' big guns challenged the Russian, and he denied them all. For the record, it was a 51-save performance, but over half of those were major league stops. Habib Boulin saved the Jets from extinction. Without his brilliance, they would have become the Phoenix Coyotes. So not only did he keep the series alive, he saved the team for the time being. Yes, he's delivered the Jets to Game 6 and afforded the Sea of White another opportunity to see its team. The Stanley Cup playoffs on Molson Hockey Night in Canada will return to the Winnipeg Arena in just a moment. The Jets and the Wings are all set for Game 6 of their conference quarterfinal series.
Hell is a world where you have no home. And even though I was in heaven, something drew me back to my home. I can't put into words the things I've seen, the places I've been, or what it all means. Because it's not so much what you look at, but when you look, what you see. And now I see that my eyes are the eyes of the world. In my eyes, I am.
It's no surprise that Canada exports so much, when you consider how much Canadians have to offer the world. That's why since 1990, Ford of Canada has invested some $4 billion in this country and its future, so that we can build vehicles right here, not only for the roads of Canada, but also for the roads of the world as well. Ford and Canada, same road, right direction.
Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC. Brought to you by Molson Canadia. By Ford Motor Company of Canada Limited. And by Pepsi. Nothing else is a Pepsi.
Well, I hope the roof to this building is well constructed because Jet fans this afternoon are ready to raise it. Mike Vernon, his third start in goal for the Red Wings in this series. He has been their road goaltender. Nikolai Habibulin has been the only goaltender the Winnipeg Jets have even thought about for this series. Rob Schick will referee this afternoon. Randy Mitten and Brad Lazarowicz are working on the lines. Can the fans keep up the constant roar for 60 minutes? They did it last Sunday, and they'll try hard again today. Keith Tkachuk with the first hit. Behind the net, it's Ed Olczyk. Looking out front, he couldn't center it. Bob Airey will play it off the boards and down the ice. Oleg Tverdovsky had pinched in and put a hit on him as he threw the puck up ice.
Well, it's a terrific start of the hockey game for the Winnipeg Jets. Good hit initially by Keith Tkachuk, and Oleg Tverdovsky followed up. It's exactly the way Terry Simpson wanted his players to start this game. Let's take a look at the forward lines. Might notice Kirk Maltby reinserted into the Detroit lineup. Scotty Bowman elects to go with the same road lineup he used in game number four of this series. No changes for the defense pairings for the Red Wings. And why would they make a lot of changes, Don? They have played so well. We talked about Keith Tkachuk. First shift of the hockey game, he gets a real good bump. Forces the turnover, gets the puck deep. There's no question Terry Simpson wants his forwards to continue to apply the pressure down deep in the Red Wing zone.
And he has also talked to his team about getting more shots themselves. And discipline is another key word that has been stressed by Terry Simpson. Along the boards, it's Korolev attempting to move it. It comes free to Fraser Zhandoff with a quick shot. It is blocked and it's knocked down by Larionov. Racing into the corner after it is Neumannin. Konstantinov got there to knock him off the puck. It's loose. Larionov trying to work out from the corner. Throws it into the slot. Nobody there. Here's a race for the puck. But Fedosov was able to get back ahead of Fraser.
That time, Don, both Detroit defensemen, the two Russians down low pinching on the play. When the pass isn't connected, of course, they leave themselves very vulnerable.
First shot on goal by Dave Manson. He has scored twice in this series. Loose puck picked up by Shane Doan. This Winnipeg team attempting to duplicate the performance they came up with in game three of this series, where they were very physical from the opening faceoff.
No question about that. And remember, one of the big players in that game number three was Shane Doan, who had himself a terrific night. And it's going to be the muckers and the grinders that perhaps will make the difference for Winnipeg in this afternoon's game. Let's take a look at the forward lines for the Jets. We've got to talk about the fact that Jim McKenzie has been inserted into the lineup for Winnipeg. Remember, the Jets suffered a couple of crucial injuries so far in this series with both Dallas Drake and Chris King out of the lineup. No change back of the blue line for Terry Simpson. And a new assistant coach for tonight's game.
Captain Chris King has been granted permission by the NHL to go behind the bench of the Winnipeg Jets, and the C is being worn by Keith Tkachuk.
You heard Kelly Rudy talk about the fact that there's no doubt who really leads this team. All due respect to Chris King. How Keith Tkachuk performs and handles himself affects everybody in that Winnipeg lineup.
Puck is picked up by Eastwood. He moves it back to Manson. Off the boards for Doan. Doan runs into his man but can't carry on with the puck. Now he gets it again and moves it back to Dave Manson. Manson relays it up into the center ice area, and back after it goes Paul Coffey. The fans start a chant. They've been on Keith Primo's case since the opening minutes of the hockey game. There's a solid hit down in the corner as the Red Wings come up with it. It's fired into Winnipeg territory. Dave Manson dodges a check from Primo. Primo goes crashing into the end board. Primo in front of the net. Draper trying to move it along the boards. He's tied up by Eastwood. Manson ties up his man. Now Draper gets it. Draper throws it towards the front of the goal. And it winds up and skates, and it's picked up now by McIver. He starts away for Winnipeg. McIver will dump it in as the Jets make a change.
It's terrific defensive zone work by Winnipeg. When given the opportunity to pin a red jersey up against the boards, they hold him there for that extra split second. Allows the rest of the defensive players to regroup and pick up their assignments.
Solid hit by Craig Muni as he took Maltby into the boards. And the fans roar with every hit by the Winnipeg Jets, and now Happy Bullen will cover up with Maltby and Johnson both there.
There's no question, a much different start to this hockey game than we've seen in any other game in this series so far. The Jets look full of confidence. They come out hitting. They're not missing a single check. And the Red Wings really unable to get anything going offensively at this point. Terrific start for Winnipeg.
In talking to a number of the Winnipeg players coming to this game, one, Shane Doan, I said, are you ready? He said, I'm going to be as pumped as I've ever been.
No question about that. They're standing people up at the blue line. Look at Craig Muni. Picks Kirk Maltby right over his back. Terrific open ice hit by Muni. Remember, again, you go back to game three. That was by far and away Winnipeg's best game of this series. Shane Doan had a big night. Craig Muni had a monster night.
We've played 2 minutes and 57 seconds of solid hits delivered by the Winnipeg Jets to start this hockey game. They're trying to get back on even terms and send the series to Detroit for a game seven on Tuesday. Dabrowski throws it into the slot area. Janney moves it across to Olchek. Olchek to the corner. Tkachuk races in. Coffey beat him to it. Now Janney gets it. He tried to center. Gets it again. What a save by burning off Olchek. The first big scoring opportunity of the hockey game for Eddie Olchek.
It's time to play.
Roll up the rim to win.
At Tim Hortons, where everything's always fresh.
Even the prizes.
Win.
One of 15 1997 Ford Escort LX sedans or wagons.
Roll up the rim to win.
5,000.
Raleigh mountain bikes. Or over 8 million Tim Hortons prizes.
Roll up the rim to win.
Drink the coffee first, people.
Roll up the rim to win.
They're rolling off the line.
Wow.
By Vernon, who just takes away the lower portion of the goal and manages to cover up the rebound as well.
I thought Vernon had a great line. He said, rather than the Detroit media worrying about who's a goal for us, they should be more concerned with the guy between the pipes at the other end.
Isn't that the truth?
Jamnoff moves it across ice. Loose puck in the neutral zone, picked up by Fedorov. He's forced to circle back. The Jets send a tape of the hit by Fedorov on Chris King that sidelined him for the balance of the year, but there was no suspension handed out by the man in control of such things, Brian Burke. Konstantinov has it now. He goes rink wide. Here's Kozlov coming up the middle. He shoots, he scores! Slava Kozlov gives the Red Wings a 1-0 lead with 16-14 remaining in the first.
Well, it's that speed through the neutral zone again, and Kozlov has got a full head of steam as he accepts that pass. And the one thing that the Red Wings have talked about to beat Habibulin is they feel they need to get a lot more high shots. But you see, Dave Manson got a little flat-footed, and before Newman can reach Kozlov, he snaps a good wrist shot up top and under the bar, catches Habibulin partway down. It looked like Habibulin fanned on that one a little bit. Watch the shot by Kozlov right here. I'm not so sure that this goes up and under the bar. It's about halfway up the goal, and it looks like it really handcuffed Nikolai Habibulin. The Red Wings take the lead on the first shot on goal.
Kozlov scored in game four of the series. He said he thought he had solved Habibulin, but he had a breakaway in game five all sorts of time, and Habibulin stoned him. But that time he was able to beat the Winnipeg goaltender. The puck is loose in the Winnipeg zone. Finally, it's dumped down the ice. Back after it goes Coffey. McCarty at center ice tried to deflect it in. He got a weak shot to the line. Konstantinov and Fedosov draw the assist, a centering attempt. Iserman gets the puck. He circles, being watched by McIver, taken in against the boards and down by the Winnipeg defenseman, resulting in a whistle.
Now the Red Wings turn up the forechecking pressure. The one thing that is a big for sure is that if Nikolai Habibulin is not brilliant once again in this hockey game, the Winnipeg Jets will not win. He's faced an awful lot of shots already in this series. Take a look. Second only to the Pittsburgh Penguins, but let's not forget that the Penguins played a number of extra periods.
They've almost played an extra game.
That's right. So Habibulin has been brilliant so far. He's got to shake that first goal off and recollect himself.
His shot total coming into this game was exactly double the number that the Winnipeg Jets have directed at Mike Vernon and Chris Osgood. As a matter of fact, in total, neither Osgood or Vernon have faced as many shots as Habibulin did in game five when he stopped 51 of 52 directed his way. Here comes Primo. He has yet to score in the series. Primo goes hard for the net. Deverdoski got back on him. Primo crashes into the net and takes it off its supports. 1-0. The Wings lead the Jets. Let's go to the broadcast center in Toronto and Ron McLean.
Thanks, Don. At the US Air Arena in Washington, Mary Lemieux will score on the power play. The save is made by Jim Carrey, who gets the start, but the clearing pass goes right to Sergei Zubov. He keeps it in, feeds to 66, who scores the second goal. Power play effort at 1:57 to make it 1-0 Pittsburgh.
Well, Keith Primo continues to be stymied by Nikolai Habibulin, but he has not been without chances.
That's for sure, but a nice play by Oleg Teverdoski again, who gets the angle on Primo. Really makes life an awful lot easier for Nikolai Habibulin. You know, that first Red Wing goal is pretty significant, Don, in that it was an even strength marker. And at this point in the series, you look at the goals scored even strength going into tonight. The Red Wings had only scored six even strength goals. The Jets had nine.
Teverdoski tried to slip it through. He has yet to score a goal as a member of the Winnipeg Jets. Now it's centered. Deverdoski can't get to it, and back comes Primo. Primo goes to the bench as the Red Wings make a change. Habibulin almost had that puck fooling. It took a bounce just as he went down to play it, and for a moment, he had palpitations thinking it might have slipped past him.
I'll bet his heart is racing right now, because watch the bounce here, the flip in by Primo. It takes a couple of strange hops, but at this stage you almost can sense that Habibulin is thinking one step ahead of himself. He's very fortunate that puck did not drift out from under the goal pads, because Cicerelli was right on the doorstep. Look at that strange bounce at the last second. Whenever you see that goaltender look over his left shoulder, you gotta be concerned.
That could have been a strange goal. The guy on the bench being credited with the goal when it went in, because Primo dumped it in, the soft dump in, and went immediately to the bench when Habibulin was having problems with it. Chopped up along the boards. Korolev knocks it ahead to Zhamnov, coming in against Konstantinov. The Red Wing defenseman takes him out of the play. Kozlov comes back to pick it up. Now the Red Wings start out 14-22, remaining in the opening period. Fedorov is cut off at the line. Finlay banks it off the boards. Zhamnov gets it again. He manages to dodge a check, can't poke it past Fedosov. And back comes Kozlov, the goal scorer for the Red Wings. Stopped at the blue line. The Jets can't gain control at center ice. It's fed too far for Fedorov. He and Newman go to the corner. Newman ties him up as Shannon comes back to pick up the loose puck. The Winnipeg Jets on the attack with Manson leading the way. Long shot, he hit the post. Oh, he fooled Mike Vernon with that blast from center ice and hit the post.
Vernon looked like he thought Manson was just going to dump it into the corner, and he was starting to lean to his left to get out of the goal crease. Manson fired it far post. The Jets come within a quarter inch of tying this game up.
Shane Doan trying to work his way in, taken out of the play by Mark Bergevin. And then Maltby is hammered to the ice by Chad Kilger, back of the Red Wing goal. Let's again go to the broadcast center in Toronto and Ron McLean.
All right, Don, this isn't as dramatic as Manson's goal would have been, but it's not bad. From the high slot again, the Rangers have been really effective here. Messier to Pat Verbeek, and a beautiful snapshot, his first goal of the playoffs. Bukaboom with the other assist, 6:24. It's 1-0 New York.
Dave Manson comes awfully close to tying this game up. Watch Vernon, top left of your screen. He's going to make that initial move to his right, and as he's leaning, Manson fires a rocket back to the far post, beat him cleanly. Vernon fortunate. There's no question that would have changed momentum around in this hockey game. The Jets continue to take runs at the Red Wings. They continue to take those runs, and they continue to force turnovers as well.
Well, this is a very emotional game for the Winnipeg Jets. The fans are really into it, every bit as loud as they were for games 3 and 4, perhaps even more so. Craig Muni chases the puck down in the zone, along the boards to Teberdovsky. He can't poke it out. Airy keeps it in. Airy runs into some traffic, including one of his own players, and Teberdovsky starts away. 4-on-3 for the Jets, but at the line, Teberdovsky got turned around. The Jets are forced to shoot it in. Olchek throws it out into the slot. Nobody there, and it's dumped out to center by the Wings. 12:50 remaining in the opening period. It's a 1-0 lead for the Red Wings. Vernon had some problems trying to play the puck. There's going to be a penalty, and I think it's going to be an interference call. And the Winnipeg Jets will be shorthanded, the first penalty of the game.
Fine vehicle, 96 Windsor. It's got...
You're obsessed. You couldn't go 20 seconds without talking Ford.
Game on.
Oh, look, a new Aerostar. And a Villager. We have our own little minivan store.
It's a Ford Minivan Center! Minivan Center!
He is obsessed.
It's always been Ford.
Now's the time to lime your lawn. Greenleaf Rapid Lime sweetens the soil, adds magnesium and iron, creating the ideal conditions for the grass to grow green and healthy. Greenleaf's Rapid Lime is the ideal way to lime. It's easy to apply and fast-acting. Simply spread Rapid Lime on your lawn and let it go to work greening the grass. Ask for Greenleaf's Rapid Lime. It's available at all leading garden supply centers. Another quality product from Greenleaf.
People and events that drive Canadian business.
We're just two guys flying by the seat of our pants.
Revealing.
We've been told to sell off all of our products.
Award-winning.
Has launched an attack.
Ahead of its time.
We help companies rethink their business.
Venture, tonight after Sunday Report.
The first penalty of the hockey game. Ed Olchek was called for tripping Mike Vernon as the Red Wing goaltender went behind the net to play the puck.
You know, it's a strange call because Olchek, there's no question about it. He's trying to get to that puck. He does upset Vernon, but usually the referee won't make this kind of call unless the Winnipeg Jets were going to get a scoring chance out of it. That was not going to happen. Big penalty kill coming up for Winnipeg.
The Red Wings are 7 for 33 with the man advantage. Kept in at the line by Lariana. Tkachuk said he's been the most dangerous Red Wing. He takes a shot from a sharp angle. It's left in the corner. Fed back to the point for Fedosov. Fedosov lays it cross ice now for Fedorov. He can't get a shot to the point. Fedosov winds up, shoots, save, and the rebound is cleared.
All kinds of traffic down low, and Jeff Finley doing a good job on Slava Kozlov, who's providing the screen on Habib Bulin. You don't expect to see Kozlov down there in front of the crease.
Here's Kozlov now. He gets to the line. He's stopped there. Stapleton got knocked down. In deep is Konstantinov to Fedorov. Back at the point, Fedosov. Fedorov one times it. He hit the post. Konstantinov, the defenseman, in the corner. The Jets trying to get it out. They can't get it past Larionov. Now Fedorov is checked. The puck comes to the line and is knocked out. Then Shannon gets a piece of both Fedorov and Fedosov. 52 seconds remaining in the Olchek penalty. Steve Yzerman, the Red Wing captain, is forced to circle. Jamnoff is out forechecking for Winnipeg. Now here comes Yzerman weaving his way through the neutral zone. Yzerman whips it over to Cicerelli. Back to Coffey. Coffey will shoot. Saved by Habib Bulin. Again, let's go to the broadcast center in Toronto and Ron McLean.
Thanks a lot, Don. Pittsburgh Penguins, second power play and their second goal. Zuboff and Mario Lemieux will get the assists as Jaromir Jagr scores his third of the postseason. That spells the end for Jim Carrey. He's out. Olaf Kolzig is in. And at the Molson Center, the New York Rangers have just extended their lead. Adam Graves will ultimately get credit for the goal from that goal mouth scramble, a power play effort for the New York Rangers. And they lead the Canadiens 2-0 as well.
And here it's 1-0. The Red Wings leading on a goal by Kozlov. They have 33 seconds remaining on the power play. Lidstrom celebrating his 26th birthday today. Dumps it to the corner. Picked up there by Cicerelli. Cicerelli takes a hit along the boards from Tkachuk. It comes back to Lidstrom. Over to Coffey. Coffey shot blocked by Jamnoff. Now it's picked up by Muni. Tkachuk breaking up the middle. And Tkachuk would have been offside had he touched the puck.
Well, that's what the penalty killing unit needs to start doing for Winnipeg. They have to take that puck out of the possession of the Detroit Red Wings because they can dominate a game. Check out the statistics on the power play efficiency for the Red Wings. Look at game number four. That was the last game played here in Winnipeg. Four goals on the night. Other than that, the penalty killers have done a pretty good job, but they are explosive. There is an awful lot of talent, and you really need to limit their opportunities.
Scotty Bowman's concern is the fact that his team 5-on-5 hasn't been as effective as he would like.
Red Wings come very close on the power play there. Habib Bulin beaten on the one-timer shot from Paul Coffey, but it goes out the other side. That's the first break of the hockey game. Goes in favor of Winnipeg.
The Wings have outshot the Jets by a 5-3 margin. Three of the shots coming with this man advantage. 14 seconds left in the Olchek penalty. McIver will take his time, dump it down the ice, and that should pretty much take the final seconds off the clock and bring the extra player back onto the ice for Winnipeg. Yzerman, though, gets to the line. Then he stopped, gets the puck again. Jamnoff had problems taking it away from him. Finally, it's flipped down the ice. Manson was looking for Olchek, who'd come out of the penalty box, but a Red Wing got there ahead of him. Bergevin now going back after it for Detroit. Bergevin has Olchek on him immediately. Janney in forechecking. Janney gets it again, tried to center it. It's knocked down in front of the net by Bergevin. 10-12 remaining in the first period. Loose puck picked up by Coffey. Coffey gets it over to McCarty. He's going in. McCarty shoots and the save as he had Draper cutting in from the left wing. Initially, I think he thought about trying to pass it across and then opted to shoot, and Habib Bulin made the save. After the loose puck goes McIver behind the net. McCarty and Manson were involved in a bit of a pushing duel, but nothing more serious develops.
Kerry Simpson is double shifting the Tkachuk line already in this game, as he did throughout game number five. See how much energy those fellas have as this game unravels.
Back of the net, Shannon has it out front. Picked up now by Eastwood. Penalty coming up against the Red Wings as it's flipped down the ice with 9:21 remaining in the period. And again, let's go to the broadcast center in Toronto and Ron McLean.
Two quick goals by the Rangers have made this a blowout. First of all, it's Alexei Kovalev from Al Samuelson as he streaks in. That was 27 seconds after the Graves goal. And Yari Curry makes it 4-0. Three goals, 102 apart. Luke Robitaille draws the assist here, and Pat Jablonski will spell off Jocelyn Thibault in this rout so far at the Molson Center.
Well, Scotty Bowman's team, like Montreal, was up 2-0 in this series. It's now 3-2. The Red Wings leading.
There's the penalty. Mike Ramsey on Shane Doan as Doan's driving to the net. It's an interference call against Ramsey. But just prior to that, the Red Wings come close to adding to their lead. You see McCarty's trying to get that puck across through the crease to Draper. It's a brilliant defensive play by Norm McIver. This has been the biggest sore point for Winnipeg in this series, yet to record a power play goal.
Jamnoff was knocked down back of the net by Konstantinov. The fans thought there should have been a penalty.
Good try by Jamnoff. Certainly when your power play is struggling, you can take a dive and get the 5-on-3. Look for the home call from referee Rob Schick. It would have been a nice position for Winnipeg, but Schick did not buy into it.
Loose puck in the Red Wing zone. It comes to the line, and Larionov is there to gain control and slow things down. He moves it ahead to Fedorov. Fedorov circles through the neutral zone. Every time he touches the puck, the fans react. Here's Tkachuk now. Tkachuk trying to get the puck back. It's caught up in skates. Flipped to the neutral zone where Teppo Nieminen goes back after it. He moves it over to McIver. McIver trying to shovel it through for Jamnoff. Yzerman beat him to it, and now Konstantinov will clear.
You see how aggressively the Red Wings continue to stand up at their blue line and force the issue. The Jets are unwilling to dump that puck in. They're going to have a tough time getting the power play set up.
This time it's fired in by Manson. Janney goes to the corner. It comes back to the point now to Teberdovsky. Teberdovsky throws it to the net. Vernon got a piece of it. Tkachuk lays it to the point. Manson shoots. That goes off a leg wide. And Airy will fire it out of the zone with 36 seconds remaining in the penalty.
Well, that's one of the best opportunities in the Winnipeg power play in this entire series. Appeared to have Mike Vernon beaten on the play. Just no reward.
Here comes Teberdovsky. Teberdovsky into the slot, dishes it off. Olchek's weak shot goes wide of the net. Olchek gets it again. He tries to get it back to the point. It's picked off and dumped down the ice by Taylor. Abby Bullen now moves it ahead to Olchek. He leaves it for Manson. Rink wide for Korolev, and it's deflected up into the crowd with just 3 seconds remaining in the Ramsey penalty.
Nice rush again by Oleg Teberdovsky, who's been wandering up into the offensive zone on several occasions. Mike Vernon, for a split second, thought he had given up the tying goal in this hockey game, and perhaps the second break goes in favor of the Detroit Red Wings. Take a look at Vernon from the net cam in behind. This puck appears to go right through his legs and then dribbles back out the short side. That is a tremendous break for Vernon. Look at the action down low in front. Craig Janney manages to get position, and Vladimir Konstantinov looks like he's just trying to tackle people out there.
7:24 remaining in the period. 3 seconds in the penalty. Konstantinov flips it down the ice, and now Ramsey steps out of the box. 1-0, the Red Wings leading on a goal by Slava Kozlov. Mike Eastwood on the wing for Shannon. Shannon had problems picking up the pass. Now it's Cicerelli sliding it across for Johnson. Back to Cicerelli. Konstantinov goes for the net. Shannon got back to pick him up. Penalty coming up against the Winnipeg Jets. So again, the Red Wings will have a power play with 6:56 left in the period.
You're looking at one Canadian. At a time when almost 30 million others each have their own individual dreams, goals, and challenges. Someday this Canadian will grow up and face important decisions about managing money, owning a home, and starting a family. And he's sure to have his own unique way of looking at things. Now, he may not know it, But this little Canadian is the reason Royal Bank Financial Group develops products and services that match each customer's personal financial needs. Some will be just right for him. Some more suited to others of our 9 million customers. It's how Royal Bank Financial Group helps Canadians with their financial needs, one customer at a time.
Eastwood gets the game for roughing, and discipline, of course, Don, has been a huge issue in this series so far. See, some of the big players for Winnipeg have spent far too much time in the box, but take a look at the team averages. Almost 7 minutes a game more has been spent in the penalty box by Winnipeg compared to Detroit. Pretty tough to win hockey games playing that style and that undisciplined.
Tkachuk with a good move to grab the puck as he was down, move it to the blade of his stick and flip it down the ice. Primo takes a hit from Zhamnov and the fans love it. The captain, Yzerman, will drive it in and ring it around the boards. Korolev got to it. Korolev trying to chip it out, couldn't do it against Paul Coffey. Now it's deflected to the line, kept onside. Lidstrom shoots, save, and the puck bounces to the corner where Cicerelli grabs it.
Well, that was a great save because Primo actually redirected that puck right in front of Javi Bulin.
Teponjuminen finds a hole and fires it up ice. Vernon came well out of the net to play it. Here comes Paul Coffey. Stapleton is on him, rides him out of the play. The puck whipped around the boards, now to the point. Lidstrom getting set. He shoots and fires wide. Yzerman gets it off the glass for Fedorov. Fedorov looks in front. There's Cicerelli taking up his familiar position. He fired it wide. Another shot by Coffey, knocked down by Newman, but the Jets are having problems trying to get it out. Manson bumps with Cicerelli. The puck is caught up in the skates and flipped to the other corner, but the whistle had already gone.
Rob Schick just lost sight of that puck. That's why the whistle was low, but I'll tell you what, the Jets fortunate because they did have too many men on the ice. It went unseen.
Let's go to the broadcast center in Toronto. And again, here's Ron.
Thank you, Don. The Canadians fight back. They have a 5-on-3 advantage here when the feed goes to Mark Recchi on the doorstep. Turgeon began the play behind the net. Canadians have cut the deficit to 3 goals. There's still about 8 minutes to go in the first period at the Molson Center.
Well, a wild scoring affair there. Here, just 1 goal so far, that by Slava Kozlov.
But the Jets continue to apply the body. Here's a good hit by Alexei Zhamnov and the much bigger Keith Primo. One of the keys for the Detroit Red Wings is how they will react. And there's the other fine save by Javi Bulin. Looks like Primo got a piece of that puck on its way to the goal. But again, much more consistent body work by Winnipeg in this game than we've seen in any of the preceding five.
Well, Dave Manson is a player who has to play a physical game for the Jets to be effective back on the blue line, and he also has to stay out of the penalty box.
See the discussion ongoing. Here's that Lidstrom shot coming in. Another tip play goes up and over. That was Darren Shannon that actually got his stick on that puck.
Back at the point, Konstantinov with a shot. It doesn't get through. Zhamnov banks it off the boards and just got it out. Tkachuk steps into Fedosov. Now Konstantinov works his way to the line. He goes in deep. Pass goes to Fedorov. Fedorov circles to the corner. Being watched by Muni. Now back to Konstantinov. Return to Fedorov. Kozlov is in front of the net. Rink wide to Fedosov. In deep. Here's Fedorov now. Kozlov, he scores! Fedorov into the slot and just slid it across to Kozlov. 2-0 Detroit.
Well, it's a Slava Kozlov show right now. I tell you what, Dave Manson gets caught in no man's land here. He's in between Fedorov and Kozlov, and it looks like he's a little bit unsure about who to attack. Take a look at it. Whenever they can split up the box and make those seam passes, there's the pass from Fedorov. He actually fans on it, goes right onto the tape of Kozlov. Watch Dave Manson. He's a little bit unsure about how to play this. Fedorov's got the puck in the slot. He doesn't know whether to challenge him or stay with Kozlov. Irregardless, the fan shot by Fedorov goes right onto the tape, and Kozlov has become a finisher in a hurry here.
The third goal of the playoffs for Slava Kozlov has the Red Wings in front by a score of 2-0. And that's now 8 power play goals for the Red Wings in this series. They have scored one more goal on the power play than they have at even strength. 4:47 remaining in the period. It's left in the corner for Stapleton. Stapleton moves it across to Manson. Manson dumps it in. Going back after it is Ari Kilger. Hammers him in against the board. Loose puck picked off by McCarty. McKenzie gets back to take it away from him. McKenzie in the lineup for the first time since game one of this series. McKenzie gets back to try and feed it ahead to Stapleton. It bounced away from him. The Jets are making a change. It's Coffey. Dumps it to the line. It's blocked there by Ed Olchek. Olchek to Tkachuk. Tkachuk in across the line, working his way through. Tkachuk is checked as he tried to go to the net. The puck slid to Mike Vernon, and he was able to cover up. 4:03 remaining in the first. 2-0, the Red Wings lead.
You were on the phone a long time last night.
Who'd you call? Just for fun, who'd you call?
I called everybody.
Everybody here, everybody back home.
Everybody back home, I gave them a call.
All right, you're gonna go bankrupt on your phone bill.
Yeah, well, I hate to disappoint you guys, but you should see the deal I got.
Yeah, and only 3 numbers.
All numbers.
Introducing a long-distance plan that makes sense. 25% off all calls, anytime, anywhere, when you spend $25 a month. Call 1-800-958-9999.
Right, so can you call Hong Kong?
Yeah, I could call Hong Kong.
Now, did you call Hong Kong there, Cheesy? You talked to Laura?
You did, didn't you?
You called Laura in Hong Kong.
25% off all calls, anytime, anywhere, including overseas and calling card. To save on all your calls, call 1-800-958-9999.
You know, where there's a spark, there's a flame. laugh like you will.
Okay.
Laugh at the downhearted.
Nice talking to you.
Here's an update with Ron Francis from Peter Nedved at the U.S. Air Arena. Makes it 3-0 Pittsburgh.
And here, Ron, it's 2-0. The Red Wings leading the Jets. The faceoff in the Red Wings zone. Janney goes back to the net, tried to throw it out front. The puck bounces. They score. Tkachuk. The Red Wings claiming a high stick, but I don't think so.
I don't know. They're going to go upstairs for this one. I'll be very surprised if this goal stands up. Puck initially appeared to be well above the crossbar. Keep in mind that is the determining factor. Well, it doesn't matter where the player swings his stick from. It's the point that he makes contact with the puck. Here's a look at what the off-ice officials perhaps will be seeing. Clearly it looks that the stick is well above the shoulder of Keith Tkachuk. There's no way that goal is going to stand up. And you can kind of see it in the eyes of Keith Tkachuk that he does not expect it to.
Well, initially I thought the Tkachuk's stick had made contact with the puck when it was down lower, but obviously, as we saw in the replay, he did get it up high.
Well, here's another look, and you see how high, and again, the determining factor, the crossbar. That puck's a good foot and a half, 2 feet above. Certainly no doubt in the mind of Mike Vernon.
Craig Janney now takes his time. Brings it around the boards, going to the corner after it is Lidstrom. He leaves it there for Ramsey. Ramsey has his pass cut off by Teberdovsky, but he couldn't control it. Now it's Craig Muni. Over to Teberdovsky. He falls. Primo gets it. Primo in front looking for Yzerman. It was beyond his reach. Primo has it again. Primo centers it. Yzerman scores! Boy, oh boy, the Red Wings have capitalized on their opportunities in this first period and now lead it 3-0.
Well, we talked about the fact that Keith Primo has had a quiet series so far. Well, he makes his presence known on this last shift, and it's a beautiful feed. from Primo to Iserman. Let's take a look at it. The Red Wings just continue to chip that puck. Cicerelli in behind the net. Look how much time Primo has. Two white jerseys, both defensemen surround him. That's what leaves the slot wide open for Iserman. And again, another high shot from the Detroit Red Wings, expecting Javi Bulin to go down early. Finds the top corner, a commanding 3-0 lead in this game.
Iserman's second goal of the postseason. His other goal was on the power play. This is his first at even strength. Well, the Winnipeg Jets didn't want to fall behind the Red Wings early in this hockey game, and they certainly didn't want to fall behind 3-0 in the first period. Here comes Jamnoff now. Jamnoff works to the line. He stopped there. Fired back in by the Winnipeg Jets, but the two players who were in deep have to come back to touch up. Here comes Kozlov. He's already scored two. He's knocked down. The puck is loose. It winds up in skates. Jamnoff can't get out. Kozlov has it again for Larionov. He's checked. And now Jamnoff starts back. Jamnoff drives it into the corner. Korolev goes to the bench as the Jets make a change. 2:40 remaining in the first period. 3-0, the Red Wings lead. Malte being pressured by Eastwood. Doan goes to the corner after the puck, trying to free it for Eastwood. It's banged to the other corner. McIver trying to play it around the board. Shannon steps into Bergevin, sends him flying. Cut off at the line by Doan. Through traffic, it goes wide. Eastwood trying to center. Shannon comes in to help out. Shannon looks back to the point, now to the front of the net, centers it, and Doan couldn't control it. Larionov will clear.
More and more, you see those Winnipeg defenders getting right down almost to the hash mark in the offensive zone. That old double-edged sword, of course. You have to make the correct decisions when to go and when to stay back.
Coffey moves it over for Taylor. Johnson takes a hit from Shane Doan as McIver starts back for Winnipeg with 1:44 remaining in the period. McIver gets to the line, but it's an offside call and a penalty call, I think offsetting minors.
Hi, I'm Art Drysdale, and this is the Garden Claw. Using spades, forks, or cultivators can be back-breaking. The Garden Claw has a patented design that virtually eliminates bending and lifting. Turn the handles and the steel tines corkscrew down into all soils, even clay. It's perfect for mixing in peat and fertilizer, and it's ideal for working around plants and shrubs. The Garden Claw is backed by a 100% guarantee.
Look for this display.
Available at True Value, Beaver Lumber, Home Hardware, and Co-op stores.
You're absolutely right, Don. It is offsetting minor penalties levied against Rick Johnson and Chad Kilger of the Winnipeg Jets. Take a look at that last Red Wings goal and watch what Iserman does with that puck. You can tell by the way that he angled the stick, there was no question he was trying to go up and under the bar. But you know, it's not like the Jets have not come close in this hockey game. There's a shot by Mike Vernon. Chad Kilger, who was trailing the play. Kilger now finds himself in the penalty box along with Johnson. First chance for 4-on-4 hockey this afternoon.
The third Red Wing goal at 16:31, Iserman from Primo and Cicerelli. 3-0, the Red Wings lead. Tverdovsky is able to cut it off. Jamnoff tried to get it back to the point to Tverdovsky. It was picked off by the Wings, and Iserman moves in. Coffey goes to the front of the net. Coffey couldn't get a stick on it as it slid right to the goal mouth.
There's that element that the Red Wings bring to the table, especially in the 4-on-4 situation. Paul Coffey jumping up into the offensive zone.
And at this time, we say hello to viewers all across Canada. I'm Don Whitman along with Brian Hayward and Scott Oak at the Winnipeg Arena, where the Red Wings have taken a 3-0 first period lead. Detroit trying to close off this series this afternoon. They don't want to go back to the Joe Louis Arena for a Game 7 on Tuesday night.
You know, the ironic thing about this game is it's one of the best periods that Winnipeg has played in the series. They've come close several times to getting that puck in behind Mike Vernon. But the Red Wings are starting to finish off each and every one of their opportunities, and that's also the first time that's happened in this series.
Here's Lindstrom moving in. Saved by Happy Bullen, and the big rebound gobbled up. Fed ahead to Tkachuk, but it bounced over his stick. Coffey starts back. The transition game so effective for the Red Wings. Yzerman was offside.
Transition game, and you know, again, there haven't been a lot of turnovers on the parts of the Winnipeg Jets, and you would expect that overall Terry Simpson would probably be pretty satisfied with the way his club is playing. It's been their most physical game in the series. Yes, they've had their chances against Nikolai Habibulin, but what period haven't they had their chances against him? Simpson, more than anything, has got to be frustrated by the breaks in this hockey game, and he knows he's going to have to get production out of his big line in this game tonight to have any chance whatsoever to come back. You see, so far, they have not been productive.
And for the viewers who have just joined us, Keith Tkachuk thought he had scored a goal, but it was ruled that he made contact with a high stick. At the time, it was 2-0 for the Red Wings. And early in the hockey game, Dave Manson from center ice rang one off the post when it was 1-0 with the Red Wings leading. We're in the final minute of the first period. Konstantinov taking all sorts of time back to the net. Now he finally moves it ahead to Fedorov. Coming in against Teppo Niemenen, fires it wide. Fedorov leaves it in the corner. Larionov trying to free it, and he does. Fedorov looks in front for Coffey. The pass doesn't get there, and the Jets start back, led by Niemenen. He dumps it softly to the corner as the Jets make a change, and Fedorov goes back after it with 18 seconds remaining in the period. Larionov circles at his own line. Red Wings making a change. He waits. Taylor gets it. He fires it and goes off the blocker of Habibulin. 5 seconds remaining in the period. Manson will probably try and drive it in deep, but the Winnipeg player won't get there in time as the horn sounds to end the first period. And the Red Wings have jumped into a 3-0 first period lead. 2 goals by Kozlov, the other by the captain, Steve Yzerman.
Introducing two of the most amazing products on television today. This is Removal, a powerful cleaner with 1,001 uses. Watch it whisk away ugly hard water stains from this sink in seconds. Even a toilet bowl this badly stained is no match for Removal. Keeps coffee makers, decanters, kettles, and steam irons clean and perky. Removal dissolves winter salt from rugs, powers rust off lawn furniture, and cleans calcium-encrusted humidifiers so fast and easy, you won't believe your eyes. Also look for Stop Leak, the miracle sealant. Leaky gutters can be a very expensive headache. Spray on Stop Leak, the miracle sealer from SuperTech, and look. Expert repairs in minutes, no expensive renovations. Fix drain leaks in hard-to-reach places. Seal exhaust fans, cable access ports, chimney flashing, air conditioner lines, anywhere water or air infiltration's a problem. You could even winterize windows with Stop Leak, the miracle sealer. Stop Leak and Removal, two of the amazing family of products from SuperTech.
Available at Canadian Tire, Zellers, Kmart, Superstore, PV Mart, and other fine stores.
Face it, no other razor shaves closer or with more comfort than Gillette Sensor XL. Soft microfins that protect your skin and individually spring-mounted twin blades that adjust to your face. No razor feels more comfortable during your shave or leaves your face smoother after. Gillette Sensor XL. And try new Gillette Shave Gel. Now our best gel takes care of your skin, too.
I'm Jim McKay with another update from the 2020 Global Games. Little shot Glenn Keller captured the goal today on the highly uneven bars, while Austria's gentle giant Milos dominated the one-ton power lift. The highlight of the day so far was the record-breaking 300-meter dolphin relay.
The world of sports is ever-evolving, but athletes of today can choose all-sport body quencher for fluid replacement, unsurpassed taste, thirst-quenching flavors.
Coming up later, the graduated hurdles.
To be able to get to the green quickly, you don't need expensive equipment, advice from a pro, or a lot of hard work for that matter. To get to the green quickly, you need FedEx. It's the fast, easy way to fertilize and eliminate weeds, giving you an almost instant green, weed-free lawn.
Get quick results for your lawn with FedEx from Green Cross. First aid for lawns and gardens.
Stanley Cup Engravings. Brought to you by Ford Motor Company of Canada Limited, proud sponsors of the Hockey Hall of Fame and makers of the 1997 F-150, built for today's driving needs.
Tonight, a victor's spoils spoiled.
The job was to build a tough truck. So we put the new F-150 through hard labor and came up with features that work. The only super cab with a standard third door. The only 60-40 split rear bench. More foot room, more headroom, and the only standard dual airbags in its class. We figure if it can handle the punishment from 9 to 5, it should work just fine on weekends. The all-new 1997 Ford F-150. Strength after strength after strength.
The 1995 playoffs were a dream come true for Claude Lemieux. He played a key role in the New Jersey Devils' surprise run to the Stanley Cup. Claude led the NHL during the playoffs with 13 goals, combining his scoring touch with his usual feisty style. His efforts were rewarded with the Conn Smythe Trophy, his name on the cup. However, a dispute with management in the offseason meant a trade to the Colorado Avalanche, making Claude Lemieux the only Conn Smythe winner besides Wayne Gretzky to be traded before the next season began.
Stanley Cup engravings. Brought to you by Ford Motor Company of Canada Limited, proud sponsors of the Hockey Hall of Fame and makers of the 1997 F-150, built for today's driving needs.
Good morning. At Fidelity, we know you have only 24 hours to spend today. No less and no more. We understand there are demands on your time. Some you wish you didn't have. And others you wish you had more time for. That's why we recommend you spend a little time with someone who can spend the time you don't have. An investment professional who can tell you about the 9 million investors in Canada and around the globe who have made Fidelity the biggest mutual fund company in the world. Fidelity, through your investment professional, it's time.
This is the half face of a 57-year-old woman and the effects of time. Notice the eyelid, the wrinkles around her eye, and her mouth. This is the half face of a 57-year-old woman after regular use of Efficin. Incredibly, it's the same face. Efficin is not a surface moisturizer. It's not an irritating fruit acid chemical peel. Efficin is a totally new and scientifically proven patented skin treatment. If what you see here is not enough to convince you, ask an expert. Efficin is available from your dermatologist or pharmacist. Put Efficin to your own 60-day test. Seeing is believing.
To buy Efficin now, call 1-800-260-7608. That's 1-800-260-7608.
Through a period at both the Winnipeg Arena and the Molson Centre in Montreal, and the visitors have three gold cushions, 4-1 Rangers, 3-0 Red Wings. Kelly, that's tough for Jocelyn Thibault and for the entire Canadiens. We had thought their youth would help and they'd be ready to go, and boom, they get pummeled in the first 20.
Right. I think one of the things that we've noticed in the earlier games is if you continue to give up the slot like Montreal has, it's just going to come back to haunt you. And although they haven't scored a ton of goals from the slot earlier in the series tonight, I think three or the four goals were all scored, or the plays were generated from the slot anyways.
On the bright side, they did get one, and now it's three goals. You got at least a fighting chance, although exactly. Not a great chance. What about the goalie change exchange? You saw something you liked.
Well, I really like this. This is kind of exciting for me in that I really make an effort to get along with my other goaltender partner. And the exchange that we're going to see here may not interest a lot of people, but it certainly will goaltenders. Now, obviously, Thibault is well-liked. Look at all his teammates coming around. Now, watch this exchange, and this is obviously genuine between Jablonski and Thibault. Generally speaking, if there's no friendship, you just, like, two ships passing in the night and nothing is said. But That's really, really exciting. That reminds me of when I played with Billy Smith, and we, again, had a genuine friendship, and it was we're cheering for each other, we're competitive with each other, but that's hard to find.
And it's got to come, I think, from number one guy, because that's Thibault who was saying to Jablonski, you know, go in there and do a good job.
Absolutely. There's a pecking order, like there is in every occupation, and if Thibault absolutely had nothing to do with Jablonski, it would be noticed.
What about poor Jim Carrey? I mean, he's just been shelled by the Penguins in this series. Will he go, if they should lose today, as it looks they will, sleep on that all summer, or will he be able to think about the 9 shutouts, 8 of them in his own building, and a great regular season?
He's going to have a rotten summer. There is nothing worse than going into the summer and thinking about a poor performance or a bad playoff, and he has had the worst playoff imaginable.
Sure has. Now, at the Winnipeg Arena, Detroit came out smoking. Abbey Boulin, first shot beat him. Kozlov's was a beauty, but it was the second one that caught your eye.
Here's another interesting thing, and this really excites me when you watch players like this, and you know a player's a pure goal scorer when watch this freebie that Kozlov's going to get off the deflection off the defenseman, and he's not excited. They only get excited when they do superstar-type moves and score a real pretty goal, That attests also to the fact that they're well-schooled in their coaching and everything, and they really believe that they have a job to do, and little things like this isn't part of the big picture yet. It's getting to the finals and winning the finals.
I'm throwing you a little with this idea, but if everything ends today, the next playoff game isn't until Thursday. There have been two-day windows in here. There are day games. Maybe 10 years down the line, everybody will be used to this, but do you think this is going to affect anybody to have to wait around until Thursday to play the next round?
The only good thing out of this is that you can rest some guys or get some guys back that are injured. The bad thing is that we're programmed, and we've always been programmed our whole lives to play on consecutive nights or only one day rest, and this is where the trouble lies right now. 10 years, like you said, maybe they'll all be programmed for different nights and afternoon games and so on, but we older players are programmed differently.
Right. Chris Chelly's going to be old age. He'll have to retire by the time they start the Hawks next round. We'll be back with more as we continue our coverage of the 1996 Stanley Cup playoffs on Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
Come to Edmonton's greatest compound clearance sale, featuring over 500 brand new General Motors vehicles. South Park, Pontiac, Cadillac, Buick, GMC truck, and Don Wheaton Chevrolet's Geo and Chev truck are combined at 6630 99th Street for the compound sale. 200 trucks and vans, 70 Sunfires, Cavaliers, 20 Cadillacs, 50 Buick, Olds, Regals, Cutlasses, over 100 Grand Ams, Grand Prix, Monte Carlos, and Luminous, and 40 Geo and Fireflies. One location only, 6630 99th Street.
On sale now, one of the greatest animated classics of all time is on video for the first time.
Yeah!
Walt Disney's 20th animated masterpiece, The Aristocats. When three kittens are catnapped by a greedy butler,
they're gone!
It's up to the coolest cats in the city to save the day.
Yeah!
Own the fun-filled musical adventure your family will love.
This is outrageous! This is crazy!
Walt Disney's one and only The Aristocats, on sale for a limited time.
To help reduce pollution in the air, Brian McDermott drives on Mohawk's cleaner-burning, ethanol-blended gasoline made with prairie grain. That is, when it's his turn to drive. Mohawk, Mother Nature's gas station.
Welcome back. The trail of the Stanley Cup looks like it may see all series end today. So far, 3 goal leads for the teams that have the opportunity to move to round 2. Back with Kelly Rudy. It's 3-0 Red Wings at Winnipeg. Do you think the Jets are overwhelmed today, Kelly?
Well, we're not there, so we don't get the real feeling that somebody in that building might get watching that game, but it sure looks that way from here, and who can blame them?
Yeah, Detroit's got a lot of firepower, and when you get Kozlov and those guys going, look out. And Yzerman Primo connecting was big, too. Well, for some thoughts on what the Jets feel like, let's go to Mike Eastwood with Scott Oak.
Mike Eastwood, you have not been that badly outplayed, but you trail 3-0. Do you change anything or just keep plugging away?
No, we got to keep plugging away. Stick to the game plan. You know, we can't stray from it. We got to get the puck deep and get in and bang and create some chances and throw the puck at the net and hopefully get a couple here.
You're playing the same physical game that you played in Game 3. It worked for you then, but you've not been able to throw the Wings out their game today.
No, they've come out well, and we expect that. But, you know, I like the way our team's going tonight, and I think we get one, we can get two, and go from there.
Don and Brian join us from the arena. Brian, Kelly had the thought that maybe Scotty's trying to make Chris Osgood mentally tougher by throwing Vernon in as he has a few times here in Winnipeg. What do you think about that?
You know, I don't know about that. I think in a sense he's protecting him. In fact, he goes with the veteran on the road. Osgood plays all the home game. Scotty kind of suggested to you before the start of the series that that was the way he was going to go. And I think the media is making a bigger deal out of this than the two goaltenders. The other day, Don and I were watching the morning skate, and it was like two sprinters trying to break the tape at exactly the right moment when they left the morning skate. You know, they're having fun with it, the goalies themselves.
They're laughing about the controversy. I suggested maybe they should duke it out to see which one was the starting goaltender. Vernon said, we're going to have a golf off to determine which one is the starting goaltender. But I think this was Scotty's plan all along. Chris Osgood at home, Mike Vernon on the road. He felt the noise of the Winnipeg arena might unsettle Chris Osgood a little. He thought that the more experienced Vernon would be able to handle it.
Well, when Dave Manson fired it from 100 feet, I don't know who was calm with the noise in that building, but Chris is going to have to face that eventually, Kelly.
He will eventually, but I think if Winnipeg's going to get back into this, and these guys can correct me if I'm wrong again, Winnipeg has to shoot the puck more at every opportunity instead of making all the great plays.
That's right, but you know, Brian and I were talking between periods. This is probably the best period Winnipeg has had in the series, and they're down by three.
That's kind of the ironic thing. I mean, the puck has been behind Mike Vernon two or three times. This easily could be 3-1 or 3-2 at this point. They have hit a couple of pipes as well. They're not playing a bad game, so I don't think the Jets are going to try and change too many things.
How much chat was there about Yzerman and Primo going in? You made reference to Keith in the opening, but was the captain getting any heat?
Not yet. Not yet, because everybody else is contributing, and Vladimir Konstantinov and the goaltending situation has kind of taken the focus off those players, and in a way, those semi-controversies work very much to the advantage of Detroit.
Fedorov still has to score a goal in the series. I think he might be feeling a little pressure on the goal. The second one by Kozlov. Actually, Fedorov in the slot, I think, was trying to shoot, and it slid off his stick to Kozlov.
What do you think about day games, Brian? We were touching on the fact that the schedule is really catch as catch can, and we don't go till Thursday if it all ends today. Do you think this afternoon affair is hurting Montreal or Winnipeg?
You know, it's always a bit of an adjustment. Personally, I used to like the afternoon games because then I didn't have to go to a morning skate. I could just put the equipment on and play. I don't really think it's that much of a factor, and all of these players have played afternoon games at different times in their careers, and certainly it shouldn't be used as an excuse by anybody.
Good stuff. Thanks, fellas. Looking forward to the second period there. It's 3-0 Detroit against Winnipeg, and we'll keep you apprised of Pittsburgh, Washington, and of course the Rangers leading Montreal 4-1. We're through 20 minutes on Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
I think Ford has had its best successes when we've gone in our own direction. This is why we've given the Canadian car buyer a choice between the Taurus sedan or wagon at the same very affordable price. So they can choose the Taurus that meets their individual needs. Sedan or wagon. It's an original idea. It's a good idea.
Redesigned, re-engineered, reinvented, the 1996 Ford Taurus.
They test car batteries here. They test pickup trucks here. And when they test yard machines, they go here, Dave Spivey's house. MTD tractors, chipper shredders, and lawnmowers tackle the toughest jobs. Look for MTD yard machines at retailers near you. MTD.
Wow! I like it!
MTD yard machines, best value on the Canadian landscape. Available at these retailers.
What can you do when the simple anti-wrinkle cream isn't enough?
I look for the most advanced products.
L'Oreal introduces Plenitude Revita Lift, the double performance anti-wrinkle and firming care. With Pro-Retinol A, Revita Lift reduces the appearance of wrinkles in less than 2 weeks.
My skin is smoother.
With Pyrolasto, Revita Lift increases skin's elasticity.
Face contours are more defined.
New Plenitude Revita Lift anti-wrinkle and firming care from L'Oreal reduces the signs of aging.
This portion of Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC is brought to you by Ford Motor Company of Canada Limited and by Pepsi. Nothing else is a Pepsi.
Well, this is the first time in any game in this series that the Red Wings have scored more than once in the opening period. Right now, let's join Scott with associate coach Barry Smith.
Barry, obviously the Jets' game plan is the same as it was in Game 3. Worked for them then. How have you been able to rise above it today?
Well, I think the first goal helped. It was our first shot on goal, actually, which was good. I think our power play moved the puck really well. And after the initial first couple of shifts where they had a chance to forecheck us and bang us around a little bit, we started getting to loose pucks, moved through neutral zone. That's our key. We've got to get it out of our defensive zone as quickly as we can through the neutral zone and have a chance to skate with the puck.
What about their goaltending? Everything that's got past Happy Boulin today, he stopped in game five. You finally getting to him?
Let's see how the next period entails here. That was a good first period for us, and we're all focused on the second period coming up.
Well, the Red Wings scored three times in that first period. And as we said, the Jets may have had their best period of the series in the first period.
Here's that first goal by Kozlov, and this is a very stoppable shot. Hard to tell from that angle, but Abby Boulin actually overreacts to the puck, and it goes off his glove into the goal. And later on, he doesn't have much opportunity on the second Kozlov. Well, we talked about it. Yzerman will get, actually Fedorov will get the puck and fan on it. Goes right onto the tape of Kozlov. That's a very fortunate play. And nobody's going to stop this shot by Yzerman. Terrific play from Keith Primo in behind the goal. And that's a perfect shot right up into the top shelf.
The Jets had some scoring opportunities in the opening period, but they were unable to get it past Mike Vernon, a starter for the third time in the series. Pretty much assumed that he's the road goaltender for the Red Wings. And this is how the scoring went in the opening period, with the Wings out shooting the Jets by a margin of 12-5.
You know, and there are indications of a hockey game of what kind of a game it is. Faceoffs in each team's respective zone. 8 faceoffs in the Winnipeg zone, only 7 in Detroit zone. Compare that to the last game where after 20 minutes there were 17 in Winnipeg zone, only 2 in the Red Wing zone. You look at scoring chances as well. We had it pegged at 8-5 in favor of the Red Wings, certainly not indicative of a 3-0 game.
The team still playing 4-on-4 as Chad Kilger and Johnson are getting set to come out of the penalty box, and they are now back in the ice. Fedorov is checked in the corner by Niemenen. Jamnoff throws it up the middle for Kilger. Kilger coming in, Johnson trying to hold him off. The puck bounces high off Vernon's pass and just went wide of the net.
Tell you what, things seem to be going Mike Vernon's way in this hockey game. He's getting the good bounces.
Going after the puck is Jamnoff. McCarty tries to hit him with the check, and he may have caught a piece of him. There's going to be a penalty. It almost looked as though he stuck out a knee. Ed Olczyk, long shot, and Vernon drops that to the ice and then picks it up. And Jamnoff is bent over as he skates around in Winnipeg territory. He missed about a month of the season late in the year with back problems, but it looked as though McCarty caught him with a knee.
Well, McCarty takes a real run at Alexei Jamnoff, and Jamnoff just caught him at the last minute. He had his head up, saw McCarty coming in, and watched a little jump by Jamnoff to get out of the way. You can see that McCarty is leading with the right knee, and there is knee-to-knee contact. Jamnoff was kind of gingerly making his way over to the Winnipeg bench. Just moments earlier, Chad Kilger had a pretty good scoring chance. Again, strange bounce around that Detroit goal crease. Vernon has no idea where the puck is, and it bounces just about a foot wide of the goal.
Well, the Winnipeg Jets 0-25 in this series with a man advantage. Back at the point, Jamnoff gets it. He shoots. It's blocked and knocked down the ice by Steve Yzerman. Niemenen has to go back in a foot race with Yzerman to that loose puck.
You know, just before they dropped the puck, Alexei Jamnoff skated over to Terry Simpson, and Simpson wanted to make sure that he was fully prepared to stay out on the ice. There were some concerns about that leg of Jamnoff after the hit by McCarty.
In the corner, it's picked up by Konstantinov, and he will clear easily. Again, the Winnipeg Jets on the shoot-ins are having trouble beating the wing defenders to the puck. Jamnoff moves it ahead for McIver. Here's the shoot-in, but back there is Chris Draper. He tried to let it go. Puck goes behind the goal. Coffey will ring it around the boards and out.
Again, one of the problems with the Jets shooting that puck in is that Craig Janney is one of the forecheckers up front, and Janney's not really one of those players anxious to get in there on the forecheck and bump and grind to regain possession.
Janney comes to the line. He tried to shovel it through. He couldn't. McIver gets it. He shoots. It was blocked before it got to the net. There was traffic in front of Mike Vernon, and the shot by McIver never got to the goal. 42 seconds remaining in the McCarty penalty. Nevrodovsky leaves it for McIver. McIver flips it in softly. Back after it goes Ramsey behind the net. Shannon tried to get to it, pulled past him by Lidstrom. Now Stapleton in the corner, plays it back to the net for Shannon. Shannon leaves it for Stapleton. Stapleton against the end boards, is knocked down. Larionov is there, can't get it out. Now Fedorov takes the puck and moves it ahead to Lidstrom. To Fedorov, Fedorov gets it over to Larionov. 5 seconds left in the penalty. Larionov has it taken away. Back comes Stapleton as the Red Wings are at full strength. Dumped in by Stapleton and picked up now by Fedorov.
The Red Wings just get such tremendous support on the puck in all zones of the ice. And whenever it's in question, there's always two or three red jerseys surrounding a white one. They outman Winnipeg at every opportunity.
Dabrowski's long shot deflects high up into the crowd with 16:47 remaining in the second. It's still 3-0 Red Wings.
In the wind and the rain, I found myself. Though I was never really lost. It took me this long to realize I was looking the wrong way. Unfortunately, our eyes look out at the world, not in at ourselves. So even though at this time I find myself on this road, there are at least as many roads as there are people. And through the wind and the rain, the thunder roars.
Determination, pride, and community spirit. It's a positive energy, and we can feel it every day.
Two highlights to report. First at the Molson Center, the New York Rangers lead is now 4-2. Pierre Turgeon's shot went off of Kovalev. Kintel and Savage assisted. 2:11 of the second period. And at the US Air Arena, that's Dale Hunter beating Ken Reggett from Sergei Gonchar with his first of the playoffs in 1:43. So it's Pens by two in the second there, Don and Brian.
And here, 3-0 Winnipeg as Jim McKenzie moves it ahead for Eastwood. Eastwood was checked at center ice. Draper has the loose puck. Slides in across the Winnipeg line, brought out by McIver. Doan trying to get to the corner after it. He was cut off. It bounces to the line. Manson leaves it there for Eastwood. Doan trying to take up pursuit of the puck again as he goes after Primo. Primo with Tkachuk catching a piece of him, and both of them go down. But now Coffey starts away. He has Draper minus his helmet up with him. Coffey looks for Draper. Draper takes it back of the net. He tried to center and was checked by Tkachuk. Tkachuk throws it to an open wing. Back there to pick it up is Fedosov. The fans trying to get back into this game and provide some support, and a bad bounce out of the corner. Got Javi Bullen moving the wrong way, and he was fortunate that there wasn't a Red Wing player moving in on him. Kiver falls on top of the puck and holds it long enough for a faceoff with 15:30 left in the second.
Take a look at some of the ice times for the prominent players in this afternoon's hockey game. Keith Tkachuk logging just over 8 minutes in that first period. Fedorov was out there a fair amount himself. Tkachuk, I think, has been a real force in this afternoon's hockey game. The two number one defensemen for each respective team also putting in their minutes on the ice. And Teppo Neuminen, although he hasn't been an offensive force in this series, is always out there against that Russian unit.
It seems that Neuminen, during the course of the season, is back in the blue line against the top line on every team in the league. Here comes Dabrowski now, trying to use his speed to advantage as he hits the center line. He dumps it in. He was held up by Ramsey as he attempted to go after it. Dabrowski gets back to the point, can't keep it onside though, and McCarty will fire it down the ice, and this will be an icing call against the Wings with 15:07 left in the second.
It certainly appears that the Jets have come out strong again in this second period, Don. There's no seeming lack of poise on their part. Terry Simpson has them sticking to the game plan, which is to continue to apply the body. Every once in a while, have Oleg Dabrowski or Teppo Neuminen jump up into the offensive attack. The problem is that they're just not getting the bounces in this hockey game.
And the Red Wings are doing a pretty good job of holding them up as they attempt to go in after those shoot-ins.
You know, that's a given in this series. Detroit is such a strong defensive hockey club. They're not going to give you very much. And that's why you need to get a break if you're going to have some success against them. They certainly don't give you many second opportunities around the goal.
Fraser is out there, along with Korolev, the two-flank center Alexei Zhamnov. The Red Wings win the draw as Fedorov drew it back into the corner, now takes a return pass. Moved over to Larionov. He accepts a return pass from Fedosov, but he can't continue on with it. He does get it again, however, but it's intercepted by Muni. Muni goes rink wide now to Neumann. He was looking for Fraser breaking up at the blue line. And there's a penalty coming up as Alexei Zhamnov was hauled down.
Zhamnov's another Winnipeg player who I think has had a very strong game so far. Zhamnov, not sure which way the call is going here. Fedorov trying to figure out exactly what's happening. And this is going to be evened up. Both penalty doors are open. There you see Zhamnov pulled down with the hook right at the blue line. But there appeared to be an unsportsmanlike conduct penalty called as well. It was Igor Larionov that got the stick up on the right hip of Zhamnov right at the Detroit blue line. Bowman's taking a peek up at the scoreboard here to figure out exactly what Schick is called at this point.
And you're absolutely right, Brian. It's an unsportsmanlike conduct call against Zhamnov. He obviously said something after the penalty was assessed against Larionov. Rob Schick, the man in charge this afternoon. But initially, it appeared as though the Jets were going to have a power play. Now that is negated by the offsetting penalty against Zhamnov.
Igor Larionov taking a look over at his fellow countryman and just kind of acknowledging him.
What do you think? Are they speaking in Russian or English down there? Here comes Yzerman working against Finley. He pokes it through to Airy. Airy, no one to give it to. He decides to dump it in. Ed Olczyk is checked in the corner. Finley taken in against the boards. Yzerman has it. Back to Coffey. Quick shot. And Javi Bulin reacted well to that one. Now it's Teppo Neumann leading the attack for Winnipeg. He is Olczyk breaking down the left side. Neumann had to hold up as Olczyk would have been offside had he dumped it in. Red Wings make a change as Lidstrom starts back. He plays it ahead for Kozlov. He's already scored two. No whistle as it's stopped by Javi Bulin, and now McIver pushes it ahead to Korolev. Korolev was looking for Shannon streaking down the right side, and again, it was broken up by the Red Wings. They've done such an effective job. Here's Kozlov, two on one with Konstantinov. Konstantinov shoots, that goes off the skate to the corner. 13:37 remaining in the second period. 3-0, the Red Wings lead. All the goals in the opening 20 minutes. Fedosov goes back after it. Korolev trying to move into forecheck. He was held up. The Red Wings' Kozlov starts back. He has Fedorov moving up with him. The two cross at the blue line. Fedorov tried to slip it through to Kozlov, but it slid harmlessly to the Winnipeg goal crease.
Fedorov, remember, it was him that really stepped up his game in game four of this series. Was a real dominating type of performance by Sergei. When he turns on those jets, it's very difficult to control one-on-one because he has that kind of lateral ability that very few forwards have. Winnipeg continues to hit. Good bump by Shannon on Fetisov, but Fetisov does a good job of protecting that puck. That's one thing you can say about him. He doesn't turn it over an awful lot in the defensive zone. He'll take the hit to make a play.
Valley's the oldest player on the Red Wing roster, a most experienced international performer, two Olympic gold medals, a silver medal, and 11 world championships. Here's Bergevin cutting off a clearing attempt. The big rebound lies in the crease, and it's picked up by Keith Tkachuk. He moves it ahead to Tvardovsky. Tvardovsky trying to slip it through, and it's picked off by Bergevin. Bergevin loses it. Now Craig Janney has it. Tkachuk with him. Janney couldn't get the pass across. Great chance there for the Jets, and this is a two-line pass against the Red Wings. 12:49 is the time left in the second period.
Let's compare car dealers with Canadian Tire. They have licensed trained technicians. We have licensed trained technicians. They have high-tech equipment. So do we. They have nationwide guarantees. We have nationwide guarantees. They have high prices. Okay, there is one thing they have that we don't. Canadian Tire. Everyday low prices. Made better.
Introducing the Gold Digger by Garden Claw. The patented Gold Digger has three heads for planting, edging, weeding, and lawn repair. The bulk planter digs a perfect hole without back-breaking effort. Push the plunger to eject the soil. Great for spring bulbs and annuals. The Gold Digger's serrated edger gives your yard that professional look. The weeder makes weed and crabgrass removal easy. Add a plug of grass for quick rejuvenation. The Gold Digger.
Available at participating True Value Beaver Lumber Home Hardware and Co-op stores. Makes a great gift.
Fans going crazy here in Winnipeg. Mark Bergevin, who's had kind of a tough series so far, minus five in the series, turns the puck over again. The Jets sprung in a two-on-one opportunity, but he atones for his mistake because he takes away that passing lane from Craig Janney, and Janney was looking all the way to try and get that puck over to Tkachuk.
Well, the Winnipeg Jets have had their chances, but so far they have not been able to put a puck past Mike Vernon. Still 4 seconds remaining in the minor penalties assessed against Larionov and Jamnov. Gilger out there with Stapleton. He tried to go for the net from the faceoff, but the puck had not been dropped. Yuminen had some problems controlling it. The two penalized players are back on the ice.
Looked like Chad Gilger got clipped with a high stick. Rob Schick's making his way over to the Winnipeg bench to see if there's any blood drawn before he makes his ruling on the infraction. Was Bergevin the guilty culprit?
Well, Gilger is a rookie. As Rob Schick came over, it appeared as though Gilger said, "I'm okay." A veteran player might have said, "No, it's bleeding."
Might have stayed down a little bit longer, too. He is going to be a good player in this league. The size and the skills that he has, actually, with Mike Ramsey, they got the penalty. Another opportunity for that Winnipeg power play. You know, going into today's game, Don, we said if the Jets are to have a chance, they really had to start being productive on the power play. That hasn't happened yet. They have come close a few times, but they just have to bear down on their chances in around that slot area.
Listen to this crowd roar, and if the Jets could ever get a goal, they would be even noisier, if that's possible. The Red Wings continue to be aggressive with their penalty killing. Fedorov now takes up the chase. Dumped in by Tkachuk, but a Red Wing skater will get there ahead of any Jet player, and it's fired down the ice by Fedorov. Larionov took it across two lines.
You know, the Red Wings really do a good job when the puck is dumped into their zone of screening for one another. The Jets are having a tough time getting that initial forechecker in with a bead on the puck carrier for Detroit, and that's why they're able to really clear that zone and clear it very quickly. Take a look at this. You'll see what I'm talking about. Watch Lidstrom. He just kind of wards off Jamnov. That buys a little bit of extra time for Fedorov, and he has all kinds of time to clear the zone.
Olchek will try and get the puck back to Newman and on the point, but he loses the draw there to Fedorov.
Of course, the first week of the regular season, that was an interference call, but that's a whole other issue.
Well, they had indicated that in the playoffs they would again crack down on that interference call, but that has not really been the case. Tkachuk going after the loose puck in the corner, beaten to it. Cut off now by Newman. Jammed off for Olchek. Olchek is bodied off the puck, and Fedorov got it to the line, kept in by McIver. For Newman. Newman plays it back of the net. Tkachuk goes after it, lets it slide to the point to McIver. McIver for Tkachuk. Tkachuk tries to get it back to the point, and there was hesitation between Newman and Jamnov as to which player was going after it, and the Red Wing beat them to it.
Well, you'd think that Newman would have had the opportunity to really step into that one. He seemed to be only about 10 feet away from the puck.
Here comes Ed Olczyk. He drops it for Teberdowski up high. Knocked down by Vernon and the Red Wings clear. 35 seconds remaining in the penalty to Ramsey. Manson being pressured as he takes it behind his own goal. Now he hits Korolev on the fly to Janney. Janney tried to drop it back and it's picked off by Bob Airey.
Well, at some point in the hockey game, Janney has got to be willing to take those shots. Everybody's aware that he wants to pass first. His first option. If he's not a threat to shoot, this makes life a lot easier for the people defending against him.
Here comes Janney with Korolev. Again, he tried to get it across. It was intercepted. Manson manages to keep it onside. The Wings are back at full strength. Korolev for Janney. Janney back to the net. Centering attempt. That bounces off skates, and it's flipped down the ice with Manson retreating. We're at the midpoint of the second period. All three Red Wing goals scored in the first period, two by Kozlov, the other by Yzerman. Now it's Eastwood for Winnipeg. Eastwood with a move to get around Draper. Shannon steps into his man. But along the boards, Taylor tried to move it. Konstantinov comes in to help out. Jones steps into him, and the fans love that. Loose puck in the Red Wing zone. Shannon has it. Draper trying to tie him up. Doan comes in to help out. Draper comes away with the puck. Under pressure, Draper decided to bank it off the boards. It goes all the way down the ice. And this is going to be an icing call with 9:33 remaining in the second period.
Fans certainly appreciative of the effort put in by the Winnipeg Jets. They continue to get the forecheck going, and you can read into the frustrations of Craig Janney. Janney knows he has to be a major contributor to the offense of this team if this club is going to be successful. He's been shut down pretty much by Detroit.
He's fought pass far more often than shooting the puck today, and that has contributed to some of the problems.
But you got to give a lot of credit to the Red Wings defense, too. You just don't see a much gap between the oncoming Winnipeg forwards. The blue liners for the Red Wings, they really close that gap. They take away the time. They force players to make quicker decisions. And so often when that happens, they make the incorrect decisions. It's all about pressure.
Primo skates out of his own zone. He has Cicerelli and Johnson with him. Cicerelli goes after the loose puck. Primo gets there. There's going to be a penalty against the Winnipeg Jets. Primo gains control. Now for Johnson, out front for Primo. And as it's touched by Kilger, the whistle goes.
This is going to be a boarding call against Jim McKenzie. I think it's probably McKenzie's second shift of this series. And the last thing he wanted and Terry Simpson wanted was for him to go out there and get a two-minute minor against him. There's the indication from Rob Schick. McKenzie puts the grip on Dino Cicerelli and takes him into the boards. I categorize this as one of those reputation penalties. Certainly whenever a guy like Jim McKenzie gets out on the ice. Boy, you think Norm McIver might have got away with one right there against Keith Primo. Primo all alone in the slot. Red Wings on the power play once again. You can't allow Scotty Bowman to keep rolling that power play unit over the boards. You're just playing with fire.
A boarding call against Jim McKenzie. Red Wings have clicked on one of two power play opportunities this afternoon, and they have scored eight times with the man advantage in this series. They have scored an equal number of goals at even strength. From the point through traffic, Lidstrom's shot is blocked. Lidstrom gets it again. Now it's Nieminen throwing it up through the center ice area. He was looking for Tkachuk, but it bounced away from him. Chuck and Shannon out in the penalty killing role. Yzerman goes to the corner after it. Nieminen is on him. And now Finlay will clear. Lidstrom takes his time behind his own net. Throws it up along the wing where it's taken by Primo. Primo got to the line. Yzerman over to Cicerelli. Cicerelli looks back to the point for Lidstrom. Over to Coffey now. He lets it go wide of the net. Eisenman races into the corner, beaten to the puck, and Jamnot trying to clear, put it into the Red Wing bench.
Well, good job by the Winnipeg penalty killers this time. They really don't allow Detroit the time to set up any plays down low, and a couple of harmless point shots go wide of the net. Dave Manchin doing a fine job in front of Habib Boulin, keeping those lanes clear so the goalkeeper can get a look at the point shots.
8:17 remaining in the period, 1:04 in the penalty to Jim McKenzie. 3-0, the Red Wings lead. Well, the fans came to the Winnipeg Arena this afternoon prepared to raise the roof, but some of their enthusiasm was dulled with the early goal by Slava Kozlov. He scored on the Wings' first shot at 3:46.
Dino Cicerelli doing again what he does best. You know, he just goes flying towards the goalkeeper and the defenseman, and that forces people to back off. You know he's got to stop, but subconsciously, your mind is telling yourself you better back up in the crease.
Manson is able to clear. And the penalty clock ticks down to 45 seconds remaining. Fedorov leaves it there for Kozlov. Into the corner after it goes Manson. It bounces past Larionov, and Korolev starts away for Winnipeg. He flips it weakly towards the Red Wing goal, and then Kozlov goes crashing into the Red Wing net, taking it off its support, resulting in a stoppage in play. Kozlov felt that he had been interfered with as he went driving in, but there was no penalty call.
Igor Korolev, not a bad play, actually. Watch as Vernon dishes this puck off. There's Korolev. You think that he knows he's caught behind the play, and not a bad idea to knock the net off its moorings.
Now let's go to the broadcast center in Toronto, and here's Ron.
All right, Don, we'll just show you the latest goal by the New York Rangers. Second period power play, that's Alexei Kovalev. He drops to Doug Lidster. This shot actually caroms off Patrice Brisebois. No chance for Jablonski, and it's now 5-2 New York. Midway through the second there.
And will this be the first year since 1974 that there has not been a Canadian team in the playoffs after round one?
Boy, it's looking very much like that right now.
Stapleton takes it off the end boards from a sharp angle. Now plays it back to the line. Finlay tried to dump it into the corner. 5 seconds remaining in the Winnipeg penalty to McKenzie. Now he steps back on the ice as Coffey flips it into Winnipeg territory. Finley goes back after it. He's taken in against the boards by McCarty. Stapleton is bumped as he goes down, and there's going to be a penalty. The Red Wings are going to be penalized here. Coffey goes back to touch it, and that results in a whistle with 6:57 remaining. And the Winnipeg Jets will have the man advantage.
Take the Neon Value Challenge and get no-charge air conditioning along with a $500 consumer rebate. And you'll receive dual airbags, side impact beams, a 2-liter 132-horsepower engine, automatic transmission, and a whole lot more. The Neon Value Challenge, now with no-charge air conditioning on top of all these great features for the unbelievably low price of only $14,995. At your Alberta Chrysler dealers.
With most other phone cards, you have to dial a complex access code of up to 11 digits before you can even begin to dial your call.
Flight 609, departing at 6:32 from gate 26, is now boarding. With passengers in rows 18 through 35, please present your boarding pass at gate 26.
But with AGT calling card service, you just dial zero and the number you're calling. Another reason why the AGT calling card is the best card, period.
Last call for Flight 609 at 6:32, departing from gate 26.
Steve Yzerman in the box for the Red Wings. Another opportunity coming up for that Winnipeg power play. Check it out right here. Stapleton, who gets a little bit of a step on Yzerman, and he just kind of clips the feet out from under him. Good call by Rob Schick. Huge power play for the Jets.
This is the 28th power play of the series for the Winnipeg Jets. They have yet to score with the man advantage. Two number 16s race for the puck. The one wearing red gets to it. Konstantinov is able to clear. Driven in again by Numina. Kachuk leaves it there for Janney. Olchek feathers it back to the point. Jamnov to Olchek. Olchek back to Jamnov, trying to get into position. He shoots through traffic and hit a skate and is picked up by Draper. And Draper will dump it down the ice. The Red Wings change up their four penalty killers.
So aggressive, that penalty killing unit. They pressure the puck all over the ice. And again, the good passes aren't being made by Winnipeg. They just don't have enough time to make smart plays.
Bergevin trying to move it up, and with some help, he gets it down the ice. Numinen forced back in his own zone by Fedorov. Larionov is also in there forechecking. Now he is pressuring Numinen. Keith Kachuk now gets to the line, tried to make a move at the blue line, lost control of the puck. Fedorov slides it ahead for Larionov. McIver races back to cut him off. Larionov trying to stay with the Winnipeg defenseman. 34 seconds remaining in the Yzerman penalty. Here comes Jamnov. Jamnov gets to the line, still controls it. Looks for some help, leaves it at the line for McIver. McIver shoots, and that's deflected wide. Korolev along the boards. Back of the net for Kachuk. Stapleton in there trying to knock it off the mesh at the side of the Red Wing goal, but it's held there for a faceoff with 14 seconds left in the penalty.
You know, for one of the few times in this series, Keith Kachuk was able to set up right in front of Mike Vernon on the power play with a clean point shot coming in. Watch Kachuk. No Red Wing defenders really around him, but it was Mike Ramsey who actually got a piece of that puck before it reached the crease area. Good low shot from Norm McIver. Just unable to get it through.
5:11 remaining in the second. 3-0 the Wings lead. 14 seconds in the Steve Yzerman penalty.
This is the thing about the Red Wings. They throw a Ramsey and a Konstantinov out there, and they've just got so much experience back on the blue line that they rarely get caught out of position.
Along the boards, Teverdovsky fighting to try and keep it onside. He can't. Now McIver pressured back in his own zone by Draper. Draper takes the Winnipeg defenseman in against the boards as Yzerman returns to the play. Lead pass for Doan. He had problems picking it up, and the Jets have to circle back as they would have been called on the delayed offside. Taylor is checked. Eastwood can't go anywhere with it. Two Jets overskated, and Taylor comes back. 4:32 remaining in the period. It's left in the corner for Teverdovsky. Airy pressuring him. Taken away now by Primo as it's dumped back of the goal. Muni has McCarty taking him in against the boards. The Jets were initiating much of the contact in the first period. Now in the second, it's the Red Wings who are doing most of the hitting.
Well, in a way, the roles have really reversed. Winnipeg that's trying to jump into the attack, and the Red Wings defending for the most part.
And this is icing with 4:02 remaining in the second period. All three goals scored by the Wings in the first period.
In traffic, things are moving pretty slowly. Stop and go southbound due to that construction. Let's face it, the weather's not helping out either with low visibility. And we've got traffic reduced to just one lane.
There's a car company which believes that a phone with a set of wheels has always been a terrific idea. That's why they created a customer communication center. So no matter what your automotive needs, all you have to do is call 1-800-GM-DRIVE. The company is General Motors.
Stain fact. Mustard is irresistibly attracted to a lucky sweater. Nothing gets out stains better than Ultra Whisk. Stain fact. Ketchup has a spray radius of 4 feet. Nothing gets out stains better than Whisk with bleach alternative.
The Red Wings looking to wrap up this quarterfinal series this afternoon. They hold a 3-0 lead. A huge win at the World Championships in Vienna today. Paul Kariya, a three-goal performance as Canada beat the United States 5-1 to qualify for the medal round.
The Canadian team just kind of getting their legs. They've had their problems over at the World Championships, but hopefully it'll be a much different story once the medal round begins.
Primo takes a pass at center ice, was looking for Draper. It bounced away from him, and Manson slips it out to center ice. The Chuck's pass picked off by Primo. Primo put the puck behind Draper. Kuiper takes him in against the boards. McKenzie now frees it for Olczyk. He's coming in against Paul Coffey. Having problems working his way around, gets it over to Tkachuk. A bouncing puck that Tkachuk couldn't find the handle on. Manson throws it towards the net, and it's deflected into the crowd by Ed Olczyk.
This Draper's kind of an interesting story. Well, he originally was, of course, Winnipeg property and sold to the Red Wings for $1. And that was by then general manager of the Winnipeg Jets, Mike Smith. He asked John Paddock, what's the lesson here? And he said, well, the lesson is you don't be a nice guy and give up on a 21-year-old. Maybe you can be a nice guy and give up on a 26-year-old and see if he can fit into someone else's program. But certainly, Paddock would very much like to have Chris Draper back in a Winnipeg uniform.
As a Winnipeg Jet, he scored in his NHL debut in 1990 against the Toronto Maple Leafs. He has great speed, and that's what the Red Wings liked about him. Here's Fedosov's shot. Puck bounces off a body. Larionov couldn't find the handle in front of the net. Kozlov comes back to the line for Fedorov, a quick release. The puck lying loose in the slot area, and it's picked up by Zhamnov. The Red Wings continue to be very aggressive with their forechecking.
It's amazing when they have Konstantinov and Fedosov out there at the same time. At any moment, they'll jump up into the play, not just to create a scoring chance, but also to pressure the puck down low. So it's almost like at times they have four forecheckers going in there. Can't do that unless they have the ability to recognize when that player handling the puck is in trouble.
Well, the Jets have limited the Red Wings to 15 shots, but the Jets have managed just 9 of their own. All 3 goals in the first period. Here's Yzerman with a steal. Then it's taken away from him by Muni. He moves it ahead to Janney. Over to Olczyk. Olczyk will fire it in. Vernon saw that Tkachuk was trying to get there, and he played it around the boards the other way. Olczyk steps into Mike Ramsey, and there's going to be a penalty here. 1:48 remains in the period.
Maybe it's because their frames are welded instead of bolted. Or because their decks are stamped from a single piece of steel. Or maybe it's the fact that they have a high resale value.
Oh, hey, I always wanted one of these. Thanks,
man. But the truth is, when people are asked what kind of lawn tractor they'd like as a gift,
happy birthday, Dad.
Most say the same thing.
Referee Rob Schick has made another boarding call, this time against Eddie Olczyk. Watch Olczyk come in and apply the hit on Ramsey. Kind of a gray area call, I would say, because it didn't look to me like Ramsey was facing face first in towards the boards, and usually that's what the referees look for. It's the positioning of the shoulders.
Primo wins the draw, gets it back to Coffey.
You know, I also got the sense that Eddie Olczyk really held back on that hit. Why I'm even more surprised that Schick made the call.
Zhamnov in the corner, having problems with Cicerelli. Yzerman comes in to help out his teammate. Now it's fed to the point. Lidstrom had the puck up on edge, decided not to shoot it. Primo back to the net. Cicerelli trying to control it. Finally, Newman gets it, but he can't clear. Primo was trying to slip it behind his back to Yzerman. It went astray in the corner. Finally, it comes free along the boards to Zhamnov as we move into the final minute of the period. Zhamnov chops it ahead for Newman. He couldn't pick it up, and Lidstrom is back for the Wings. Over to Paul Coffey, who speeds through the neutral zone. Now looks for someone to give it to. Decides to whip it in along the boards. Fedorov to the point to Lidstrom. Now to Larionov, and Fedorov was hurt. He's still down. Fedorov remains on the ice. The Red Wings in possession. And John Wharton, the trainer, now comes off the bench to the assistance of Sergei Fedorov.
Fedorov immediately grabbed the right knee and went down in considerable pain on the ice. Detroit training staff sprinting out onto the ice. Seemed to get tangled up, perhaps with Dave Manson.
Well, Fedorov had been drawing the wrath of the Winnipeg fans because there was an issue made about the hit he put on Winnipeg captain Chris King. And as we mentioned earlier, the Winnipeg Jets sent a tape of the incident in Game 5, the knee contact with Chris King, to the league office.
There it is right there. It's a slash to the back of the leg, and Fedorov goes down like he's been shot. Pretty good two-hander by Dave Manson, but I gotta wonder about the reaction by Sergei Fedorov.
When Dave Manson first came into the league, he picked up the nickname Charlie because of his habit at times of totally losing it when he was a member of the Chicago Blackhawks. Doesn't quite play the same way anymore, but there are moments where he will give it to you.
Well, you know, it's one of the things that makes Dave Manson an effective player. When he can buy room and time for his team, certainly he becomes a force on the ice. What we've seen at times in this series is Dave Manson taking retaliation penalties. I don't think Terry Simpson has a problem when Manson takes a penalty where he's really trying to initiate something, and I don't think there was any question he was trying to initiate something right here. But see how Fedorov looks over to the referee before he begins his slide to go down into the ice. Schick doesn't buy into that at all.
So Fedorov is helped off to the Red Wing dressing room. And the Red Wings lose a very valuable performer, even though he has not scored a goal in this series. Now, he appears to be in considerable pain and having a great deal of difficulty putting any weight on the leg. And as Manson skates past the Red Wing bench, there's an exchange of words.
Well, this is Dave Manson at his best, really. I mean, this is what he does well on the ice. It'll be interesting to see if Fedorov can come back. Of course, the back of that leg is pretty vulnerable. There's not a lot of protection there.
Still 40 seconds remaining in the Olchek penalty. Cicerelli along the boards. Manages to free it. Primo takes it back to the net. Tverdovsky attempting to stay with him and finally does take the puck away from him. Kachuk was looking for Zhamnov at center ice. It bounced away from him. Now Zhamnov is knocked down and the fans thought there should have been a penalty call. Here comes Kopy. Kopy trying to go around Nieminen. Throws it out front. The puck is loose just as the horn sounds. With 11 seconds remaining in the penalty to Olchek to start the third. Let's go to the broadcast center in Toronto, and here's Ron.
Okay, we'll keep you apprised of Sergei Fedorov's condition. We're through two at the Winnipeg Arena. We're going to late stages of the second. The Canadians go to a power play. Here's Dick Irvin and Greg Miller. Power play.
And we welcome the rest of the country. I'm Dick Irvin here at the Molson Center. And the faceoff will be in the New York zone. Greg Millen after a penalty to Marc Messier. Marc Messier in the box here, and maybe a chance for the Canadians to get back in this game, but a power play goal by the Rangers, the fifth one for the Rangers, have given them a 5-2 lead very late in this second period. But the Canadians have been a little bit better today, or this afternoon, on their power play, and let's see if they can climb back once again into this hockey game.
They were down by 3 at the end of the first period, then made it 4-2. On a goal by Turgeon, and the Rangers got the power play goal by Doug Lidster at 11:33. That's the last scoring play. Lidster from Kovalev, and it's 5-2 New York.
And the Canadians have been successful working the puck down low on their power play and bringing it out in front of Richter.
You see the first goaltending change of this series. Jablonski taking over from Tebow halfway through the first period after the Rangers opened up their 4-0 lead. In the last minute of play here now in this second period, Canadians trying to set up something on this power play. They'd like to end the period on a high note. Wilkie's shot is blocked. Danfus plays it around behind the net. Samuelson is knocked down. Recchi gets the puck back. Turgeon, a drive wide. Off the boards. Wilkie keeps it in. Danfus being manhandled by Kevin Lowe. Lowe gets a stick on the puck, but Recchi intercepts in the corner for Montreal. To Valerie Burry to the side of the net. Turgeon can't reach it, and the Rangers clear it down.
What the Canadians are trying to do is pick Samuelson down low and then walk out of the corner. It almost worked for them that last sequence.
Now it's Wilkie on the rush for Montreal. 21 seconds left in the period. He shoots the puck into the New York zone. Beukenbloom is there. Fires it around off the boards and down the ice. And a good, emphatic type defensive play there by Beukenbloom of New York. 8 seconds left in the period, and the Canadians are deep in their own zone. That'll pretty well do it, I would think, for the second period. Crowd yells, shoot. Drury does. Richter stops it. And the siren goes. So the New York Rangers have a 3-goal lead at the end of two. The score, New York 5, Montreal 2.
Scientists have revealed an astronomical discovery which can only be viewed by Canadians living on the prairies. The return of a spectacular interstellar phenomenon known as Toyota Red Tag Days, featuring the best deals ever on new 96 Toyota cars and trucks. Scientists calculate Red Tag Days are hurtling through Western Canada at incredible finance rates starting at 4.6% on selected vehicles. It is visible to the naked eye, but only if you hurry down to your neighborhood Toyota dealer before Toyota Red Tag Days tail off.
Roll shutters, we installed them for security, for coolness in the summer, and to keep it dark for my shift-working husband.
This type of roll shutter, it completely blocks the light out. So we find that with it being dark in the room, we're able to sleep easily.
Roll shutters create a barrier of air, adding insulation where you need it most.
No matter where we live, we will always have roll shutters.
K&F Roll Shutters, affordable security. Ask about our flexible, no-interest payment plan. For a free, no-obligation estimate, call 440-1934.
Mix a bunch of water.
Four early birds, 40,000 ducks, and almost $2 million. We're making million-dollar duck soup.
Yum, the 10th annual Great Alberta Duck Race. Top prize, $1 million. Two $100,000 second prizes. All cash, all tax-free. 1,600 prizes in all. Don't miss the four $10,000 early bird draws. Call 1-888-DUCK-RACE or mail your entry in today. All proceeds to the Heart and Stroke Foundation of Alberta.
Indoor, outdoor, Golden Acre Garden Centers, a good part of life.
Golden Acre Garden Centers, your home of service, selection, and quality.
CBC Morning News is the first to inform you. This summer, Normalee McLeod and Bill Cameron will broadcast live from the 96 Olympics in Atlanta. CBC Morning News, the start of your day, weekdays at 7. Growing up in Australia can be a learning experience. And a painful one.
Rat bag. That's what you are.
Does a boy follow his father?
You want to ride on that sword? Take your feet off the ground.
Or try something totally different.
So I want you to have this. You like paints, don't you?
A new career.
Thanks very much.
Either way, it'll be tough. Rat Bag Hero, the CBC Wednesday night movie at 8. Stanley Cup crowd noise, brought to you by Midas, the way it should be.
Oh, hi, it's Midas-sized days, and that's why we can't afford a complete commercial. We couldn't afford the whole screen. But, you know, what we saved, we're passing on to you. For a limited time, Midas will give you a computerized wheel alignment, plus balance all four wheels and rotate your tires, all for an amazing $39.95. They even inspect your brakes for free. What a deal. Okay, so you lean in and squint, and the commercial will look perfectly normal. Huh? Midas, the way it should be. Oh yeah, an offer ends May 4th.
This is Lee Materi calling from Maple Creek, Saskatchewan. I'd like to extend a sincere thank you to the Pittsburgh Penguins and the Washington Capitals for putting on a breathtaking performance in truly one of the most exciting and controversial playoff games I have ever seen. Thank you.
Yeah, this is Justin White from Kingsville, Ontario, and in these playoffs, this is the worst officiating I've ever seen in my life. Something's got to be done.
Hi, this is John from Prince George, British Columbia. I'd just like to say that I think the reffing in the playoffs has been terrible. It's been very inconsistent, and it should be reevaluated. Thanks.
Bill Webster, Sharon, Ontario. My hockey fan wife, after watching half a game on CBC, says, I like this referee, and I don't even know his name. Maybe we should keep him. Good point, dear. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Scott. I'm from Choice, Saskatchewan, and I'd like to congratulate John Casey on the way he's been playing. Everyone thought the Blues would be dead when they lost Scratch here, but John Casey stepped in and proven what a good playoff goaltender he can be, and I hope he leads the Blues a long ways.
Yeah, this is Ryan Knapp calling from Orillia, Ontario. I just want to comment on Mike Keenan. Lots been said about him by the way he's gone to the league and made complaints, but when it all comes down to it, the guy produces a winning team.
Stanley Cup crowd noise, brought to you by Midas, the way it should be. To participate in crowd noise, call 1-900-870-0022, 95 cents per call. Callers must be 18 years or older.
Sensual, very sensual.
Hot, very hot.
Gorgeous, gorgeous, so gorgeous.
Really, really hot. You never forget.
You never forget your first one.
Red Hot Deals. Hurry.
Life Insurance Solutions for Canadians 50 to 75.
We put in long hours, but this store paid the bills, sent the kids to school. We wanted life insurance, but...
It was always last on the list.
We're listening, so we created our guaranteed life insurance plan for Canadians between 50 and 75 who worked too hard to leave their families with added bills.
Call now for more information.
You're guaranteed acceptance with no medical exam or health questions, and no salesperson will visit.
You can be covered for as little as $20 a month. Then, depending on your age and the premium you choose, you can be covered for up to $25,000, which triples to $75,000 in case of accidental death. Call now.
You know, I never want to be a burden to anyone. That's just the way I am.
Get your guaranteed life enrollment kit. Call toll-free 1-800-306-3576. That's 1-800-306-3576.
It's the dawn of a news day, and before you get to work, half the world's day will be over. Major decisions made, and dozens of news stories are unfolding. Get a head start on your day with CBC 740 Radio. Local news on the half hour, national news on the hour, and now get financial advice with FundWatch. Turn to Edmonton AM, Edmonton's morning information source. Weekdays, 5:30 to 9 on CBC 740.
Introducing the Gold Digger by Garden Claw. The patented Gold Digger has three heads for planting, edging, weeding, and lawn repair. The bulb planter digs a perfect hole without back-breaking effort. Push the plunger to eject the soil. Great for spring bulbs and annuals. The Gold Digger's serrated edger gives your yard that professional look. The weeder makes weed and crabgrass removal easy. Add a plug of grass for quick rejuvenation. The Gold Digger.
Available at Totem Building Supply, PV Mart, Golden Acres, and participating True Value.
Matinee editions of Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC. New York Rangers lead by three after two periods at the Molson Center, and the Red Wings also have a three-goal cushion after two periods at the arena in Winnipeg. Kelly, in the game in Montreal, we'll start with that. It was 4-2 for the New York Rangers, second period, and Greg Millen made the point. It looks like Coley Campbell will be happy with this matchup because he's got Messier against Koivu, and of course it didn't work.
Right, in this first clip we're going to see all good coaches get a good feel for the game. Now watch this. Two of the people that you would really think would not make a mistake. Brian Leetch falls down. Mark Messier senses that Leetch at that point had the puck. He's going to clear the zone. Next thing you know, Montreal gets a couple of great chances on goal to make the game 4-3. Campbell obviously doesn't like this, and he's going to send a message. So what does he do? He calls a timeout. And what you do when you call a timeout and it's really, when your two best players have made a mistake, you're sending a message to the rest of your bench that, hey, we're not content with this, and let's clean up our act. Next thing you know, they go out and score a fifth goal.
This one's the Ari Curry goal that actually made it 4-0 in the first period from Robitaille and Sundstrom. The Canadians then rallied. Mark Recchi scores here on the power play from Turgeon and Brisebois to cut it to 4-1 late in the first period. Second period, Pierre Turgeon scores 2-11 in from Quintal and Savage. And then, as you mentioned, the goal that really spells the difference right now is the goal that resulted from the timeout. Wilkie got a penalty, and Doug Lidstrom, who hasn't been used a lot in the series, scored the goal. So do you think the Habs have any shot of working their way into this?
I do, if they keep chipping away. But how many fluky goals have we seen in these playoffs? It's so strange with all these talented people out there, and the fluky goals seem to be the big goals.
A lot of penalties and a lot of timeouts by coaches. I don't think I can recall a playoff where so many key timeouts have worked, at least. Now, at the Winnipeg Arena, 3-0 Detroit. They did all the damage with an outburst, compliments of Slava Kozlov scoring two, and Steve Yzerman, the Red Wing captain. How often have you seen that? With he looks like Joe Sakic, only in reverse.
Nice.
Right-hand shot.
Great hands and great patience. Now, here's that slash we saw at the end of the period. And even though it does look like he's looking at the referee, I have to believe that Fedorov is injured. There really isn't a lot of protection back there, and Dave Manson's a big guy, and I know what he's trying to do. He's trying to rally his team, and they have not a lot happening right now, so try anything.
Remember, he broke Courtnell's hand in St. Louis with one of those little quickies. Here we go to the US Air Arena, and it's Ron Francis from Nedved and Tamer to make it 3-0 at that stage. But in the second period, 1:43 in, Dale Hunter, ever perseverance, first playoff goal, but he's been dynamite all through the series for the Capitals from Gonchar, and that's how it sits through two.
Well, that game is a strange game in that it's actually tied 1-1 after Carey's come out now, so I don't think that game's over, and as you said, Hunter does a lot more in a series than just score points.
All right, we're after 40 minutes in three venues, and we'll continue our coverage of the 1996 Stanley Cup playoffs on Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
Hell is a world where you have no home. And even though I was in heaven, something drew me back to my home. I can't put into words the things I've seen, the places I've been, or what it all means. Because it's not so much what you look at, but when you look, what you see. And now I see that my eyes are the eyes of the world. In my eyes, I am.
Introducing the Gold Digger by Garden Claw. The patented Gold Digger has three heads for planting, edging, weeding, and lawn repair. The bulb planter digs a perfect hole without back-breaking effort. Push the plunger to eject the soil. Great for spring bulbs and annuals. The Gold Digger's serrated edger gives your yard that professional look. The weeder makes weed and crabgrass removal easy. Add a plug of grass for quick rejuvenation. The Gold Digger.
The Gold Digger is available at participating True Value Beaver Lumber, Home Hardware, and Pro Hardware.
To make this beauty look its best, I use Armor All Protectant on the vinyl and rubber. And for the paint, now there's Armor Plate Paint Protectant. It shines, protects, and really makes those colors pop. New Armor Plate. It's like Armor All for your paint. Nobody knows protection like a quarterback. That's why I like Armor All Protectant. Test-proof Armor All blocks up to four times more of the sun's damaging UV rays than the number two brand. So don't just shine your car. Armor it with Armor All.
Hi! Looking for an ideal tank mix partner for mustard and canola?
Then look over here. I'm the ultimate in grass control.
Ha! You couldn't hit the broad side of a crackgrass patch.
Look who's talking, Mr. Afraid of Wild Oats.
Hey! I can't get everything.
You can't get anything.
If you're looking for the perfect tank mix for mustard, nothing controls wild oats, annual grasses, or quackgrass and canola like Assure.
I'll show ya.
Oh, I'm so afraid.
And now get a $100 rebate for each Assure mustard tank mix treatment you purchase.
For the first 2 years of life, everything is pretty much taken care of for you, leaving you free to explore your environment. Wouldn't it be nice to do that again? Introducing the Volkswagen 2-year lease. There's never any charge for scheduled maintenance, so you can get back to what's really important, enjoying your life. Don't try that with just any car. On the road of life, there are passengers and there are drivers.
We'll be right back.
Detroit leading Winnipeg 3-0 after 40 minutes at the Winnipeg Arena. The Wings are bidding for a second round matchup with St. Louis, and the Jets are now behind the eight ball as they try to force a seventh game in this series. Late in the period, Sergei Fedorov took a slash from the Jets' Dave Manson behind the right knee. He lay writhing on the ice for a few minutes, eventually was helped off to the Wings' locker room. He's been walking gingerly in there, and I'm told that he will return for the third period. It was a hit by Fedorov on Chris King in Game 5 in Detroit that tore up King's knee, but there is no suggestion this incident with Manson was any form of retaliation. And so it's the Wings by 3 after 40 minutes. The Molson Hockey Night in Canada Stanley Cup playoffs will continue in just a moment.
Maybe it's because their frames are welded instead of bolted.
Come here.
What are you doing?
Here.
Or because their decks are stamped from a single piece of steel.
Oh, you guys.
Or maybe it's the fact that they have a high resale value.
Oh, hey, I always wanted one of these. Thanks,
but the truth is, when people are asked what kind of lawn tractor they'd like as a gift,
happy birthday, Dad.
Most say the same thing.
Come to Edmonton's greatest compound clearance sale, featuring over 500 brand new General Motors vehicles. South Park, Pontiac, Cadillac, Buick, GMC truck, and Don Wheaton Chevrolet's Geo and Chev truck are combined at 6630 99th Street for the compound sale. 200 trucks and vans, 70 Sunfires, Cavaliers, 20 Cadillacs, 50 Buick, Olds, Regals, Cutlasses, over 100 Grand Ams, Grand Prix, Monte Carlos, and Luminous, and 40 Geo and Fireflies. One location only, 6630 99th Street.
It's the dawn of a news day, and before you get to work, half the world's day will be over. Major decisions made, and dozens of news stories are unfolding. Get a head start on your day with CBC 740 Radio. Local news on the half hour, national news on the hour, and now get financial advice with FundWatch. Turn to Edmonton AM, Edmonton's morning information source. Weekdays, 5:30 to 9 on CBC 740. It can be a learning experience. And a painful one.
Rec bag. That's what you are.
Does a boy follow his father?
You want to ride on that sword? Take your feet off the ground.
Or try something totally different.
So I want you to have this. You like paints, don't you?
A new career.
Thanks very much.
Either way, it'll be tough. Rat Bag Hero, the CBC Wednesday night movie at 8.
More than 20 minutes remaining in the 24-year lifespan of the Winnipeg Jets. The capacity crowd at the Winnipeg Arena will certainly try and do their part in providing the emotional lift for the Jets to come from behind in the third period. But the task is an onerous one, because only twice this year, when the Red Wings have led after two periods, have they failed to win a hockey game. Three goals in the first period, two by Kozlov, the other by Yzerman, and that's been the story of the hockey game. Strangely enough, the Winnipeg Jets may have played their best defensive game of the series here at home in this sixth game, and yet in the first period they gave up three goals.
I don't think there's been any question about that. It's been a relatively, I won't say easy night, but a more routine night certainly for Nikolai Habibul, and he has not been tested all that often by the Red Wings. In fact, in the second period, the Wings only had a couple of good scoring chances against Nikolai. That certainly hasn't been the tone throughout this entire series. The Jets have got to find a way to generate some offense. Scotty Bowman's defensive machine is playing a pretty darn good hockey game as well.
Now, Happy Bullen has only faced 18 shots. He's accustomed to getting about 36 per game. Now it's Craig Janney trying to feather a pass through. It was cut off by Yzerman. And again, it's McCarty in forechecking. He takes Muni in against the boards. Fans sending up a chant of go Jets go as Tkachuk comes through center ice. Over to Janney. Janney dumps it in for Olczyk. Olczyk whips it around the boards, but Tkachuk in anticipation had gone to the front of the net. Jets trying to start quickly in the third period. Janney's pass was picked off. Now he races to the boards after it, gets it back to Tkachuk. Behind the net, Janney and Olczyk. Janney trying to center, it's in skates. And Yzerman is finally able to knock it to the boards. Olczyk was searching for it, but couldn't find it.
Well, for just a split second, Craig Janney did seem to find Ed Olczyk out in front of the crease area. couldn't get a handle on it.
Konstantinov took Olchek's feet out from under him right in front of referee Rob Schick, but there was no penalty call.
Listen to the boos from the fans. And amazingly, I think those boos perhaps were for Sergei Fedorov, who is back on the ice. Seems to be skating just fine for Detroit. What a surprise.
Larionov moves it over on the wing to Konstantinov. Long shot, gloved by Abby Bullen. And he decides to hang on as he has both Kozlov and Fedorov right there. Yeah, the fans react because Fedorov looked as though he had been poleaxed when he went down. And he is able to come back and play in this third period. Now let's go downstairs and here's Scott with Mark Bergevin.
Mark Bergevin, you've got a 3-goal lead after two and you've tightened up things defensively. Is that an accurate description of the proceedings?
Well, that's what we've been playing all year. You know, people think that we got such a good offensive players that we win with our offense, but we don't. We really by playing good defense. And that's why we are where we are today, by playing good defense. And we put the puck in the net and we have 3 goals. Right?
Pressure is all on you guys today because you're supposed to be on a brisk march to the Stanley Cup. How much motivation have you drawn from that?
Well, yeah, we are picked to win the Cups, but believe me, none of the players in the room are too confident. We know whoever we play is going to be hard. Whoever, if we win tonight, whoever is going to be next. We have to stay focused, and we got a long way to go.
And if the Red Wings do win, it will be the St. Louis Blues providing the opposition. Humanin forced back into his own zone by Fedorov. The Jets were making a change, and Humanin played it to an open wing.
How about Mike Keenan already starting to get the fireworks going, complaining already that the bench in Detroit is shorter for the visiting team than it is for the home side and gives them an unfair advantage when it comes to changing lines. Mind games continue for Keenan. You want to believe he loves to be able to take a shot at Scotty Bowman when Bowman's already involved in a series. And Keenan is just waiting for the next one to begin.
Here's Manson dodging a check from Ciccarelli. Manson winds up, long shot, pad saved by Vernon. And the puck is put over the glass and out of play.
You know, Dave Manson has such a heavy shot that it's never a bad play for him to put it on net. You know, some guys, you don't want them to shoot from outside the blue line because usually the goalkeeper can handle it cleanly and dish it off to one of his defensemen, leaving in a good position in a manner that it should be able to exit the defensive zone pretty easily. But when Dave Manson winds up from the blue line, if he keeps that puck low, pounds it right into the pads of Vernon, you never really know where the rebound is going to go, and it can be another effective way to get a good forecheck going because the defensemen turn around. They have no idea how Vernon is going to handle the rebound. And you put that element of doubt in the defensemen's minds, and perhaps that'll force them to hesitate a little bit.
They play 2:53 of the third period. Still 3-0 for the Wings. McIver through traffic. The shot is right on. And Tkachuk was tied up by Coffey. He was looking for the rebound. Slips it through, looking for Olchek. Vernon has to play it, coming out of the net. You get the feeling that maybe if the Winnipeg Jets could finally get on the board, they might get more than one. Puck is loose in the crease. The Jets claiming that a Red Wing player gloved it, but the puck was outside the crease. Ciccarelli winds up and puts it high off the glass and out of play. 16:29 remains in the third period.
Hell is a world where you have no home. And even though I was in heaven, something drew me back to my home. I can't put into words the things I've seen, the places I've been, or what it all means. Because it's not so much what you look at, but when you look, what you see. And now I see that my eyes are the eyes of the world. In my eyes, I am.
Take the Neon Value Challenge and get no-charge air conditioning along with a $500 consumer rebate. And you'll receive dual airbags, side impact beams, a 2-liter 132-horsepower engine, automatic transmission, and a whole lot more. The Neon Value Challenge, now with no-charge air conditioning on top of all these great features for the unbelievably low price of only $14,995. At your Alberta Chrysler dealers.
around the Detroit crease. Wild scrum around that Detroit crease, and Keith Primo actually makes a real nice play. Look at the Jets. Keith Tkachuk standing directly in the crease. That puck is loose out in front of the goal crease, and watch what Primo does. He spots it, and he's just going to dish it ahead with his hand. Watch Primo. Takes a peek out. Vernon can't reach it. Puts his hand on the puck, but it's outside the goal crease, and he kind of bumps it ahead of the play. Detroit able to exit the zone. Smart play by Primo.
Tkachuk immediately complained to referee Rob Schick, but the puck was outside the crease. I think Tkachuk is going to get a lot of work in this third period. He was their leading scorer with 50 goals. He breaks through, and he was knocked down. Got a weak shot away. The puck comes loose in front of the net. Stapleton throws it blindly, looking to center, and it's picked off by the Wings and put up into the crowd. Now Tkachuk and Vernon are having words. Ramsey comes back and steps between them. Now let's go to the broadcast center in Toronto, and again, here's Ron.
Thank you, Don. The Montreal Canadiens do what they had to. They score early in the third period. The power play had just ended. Penalty to Marc Messier was over, but the Canadiens score. Brisebois from Turgeon and Damfus at 56 seconds. 5-3 now, the Rangers in the third period. And Sergei Gonchar has just scored from Dale Hunter in Washington. So Pittsburgh's lead's cut to one in the third there.
And I tell you what, the Jets have come pretty close to scoring in this third period. Here's that play again with Primo. Watch the way the big guy just kind of spots it and bumps it ahead of Tkachuk and Janney. That play was pretty close to the edge of the goal crease. But clearly, Primo did not break the rule. Schick was only standing about 15 feet away from him.
Yzerman is complaining. He shouldn't be waved out of the face-off circle, but he is, and now McCarty comes in to take the draw and wins it, getting it back to Toppy. The Jets trying to pressure the Wings. They have to open up. They have to try and generate some offense. Stapleton is in on Toppy, and they succeed in tying it up for a face-off with 15:40 remaining. 3-0 the Red Wings lead. You know, with Ray Bourque, Mike Gartner, and Dave Babich all being eliminated from the playoff chase, they had 17 years without engraving their name on a Stanley Cup, and it won't happen this year. So it's Mike Ramsey with 16 years without the Stanley Cup, who is the oldest active player who has never won a cup.
Mike Vernon almost daring Keith Tkachuk to take a shot at him. He's got the chin out. Scotty Bowman-like posture. Vernon gets in a little jab of his own. Mike Ramsey steps over to make sure that nothing's really going on. Tkachuk has come out with a vengeance in this third period. A couple of good rushes, driving directly towards the net. That's when he is his most effective.
Larionov with a backhand shot. And the Jets start back the other way. Zhamnov is out there with Tkachuk. Zhamnov works to the line, has to try and bank it in back of the net. Korolev having problems trying to get it free. And again, the puck is deflected high and up into the crowd.
Let's take a look at some of the significant ice times this afternoon's hockey game. You see Tkachuk's already logged 17 minutes and 27 seconds. Fedorov, despite missing a few shifts because of that injury of his, played over 14 minutes defensively. Paul Coffey, Scotty Bowman looking to wrap up the series, has been out on that ice an awful lot today. And Keith Tkachuk's already been double shifted in this third period. I'll be surprised if he spends a lot of time on that Winnipeg bench. Last scoring chance for Detroit. Nice little feed across to Larionov, but he's already run out of room. A pretty easy save for Habby Boulin from the bad angle.
Keith Primo has taken a lot of faceoffs for the Red Wings in their own zone, and he's had success. Eastwood will try and beat him here. They scramble the draw. Primo manages to get to the puck, back to the net. Doan centered it. Shannon tried to get it back to Doan. It's dumped down the ice. Puck intercepted by Dino Cicerelli. Greg Muni looks chance for Shannon. Shannon having some problems trying to move out against the forechecking of Chris Draper. Now it's Teverdovsky lugging it out, but he had difficulty controlling it. Olchek flips it down the ice. Vernon comes out to play it. Olchek cuts it off, tried to throw it towards the goal. It hit a body, and now Ciccarelli starts away. He looks to see if there's any help with him. The Wings were in the midst of a change, so he wisely dumped it in deep.
Some real disciplined play early from the Red Wings. They want to make sure that that puck does go deep every shift. They're out there on the ice, and you can get a sense that when those Red Wing forwards do get the puck in the neutral zone, they take a peek over their shoulder, and if it's not an odd man situation, then they have been told to make sure they get it in deep.
Craig Janney had problems controlling it, and Dave Manson will have to retreat with Iserman quickly on him.
Come on, Danny!
14:03 remaining in the third period. Dumped down the ice for Kachuk. Kachuk takes Arian against the boards, ties him up. Manson couldn't keep it in against Iserman, and back after it goes McIver. Ed Olchek being watched by Johnson as he flips it up to the line, broken up there by Konstantinov, and it's whistled down as it was gloved ahead to Craig Johnson.
So many red jerseys flooding that neutral zone. There's not a lot of skating room out there for Winnipeg. They need to find a way to hit the player away from the puck. It has as much speed as possible.
The Wings won the first two games of the series at the Joe Louis Arena by scores of 4-1 and 4-0. The Jets got back in the series last Sunday with an impressive 4-1 win. It looked as though it was all over when the Wings won game four by a score of 6-1. But with Nikolai Habibulin outstanding in goal in game five with 51 saves, the Jets forced his sixth game here at the Winnipeg Arena. But unless Winnipeg can mount some offense in this third period with 13:34 remaining, there will not be a seventh game Tuesday night at the Joe Louis Arena.
You know, Don, the Jets have been attacking pretty much from the beginning of the second period on. So that's a full 27 minutes of attacking. But they haven't been able to get any shots against Detroit. And you just have to really marvel at how disciplined the Red Wings are.
Oh, Chad Kilger just missed with a quick release as he was able to steal the puck. He scored the game-winning goal a week ago Sunday. A week ago today, actually, here at the arena last Sunday in the Jets' 4-1 win. Konstantinov now under pressure will fire at the length of the ice. Habibulin is forced to make the save, so there is no icing. Now it's Teverdovsky wheeling away from Maltby. He moves it ahead to Stapleton. Stapleton whips it in high on the glass. Taylor's taken in hard against the board. Stapleton has it. He can't free himself from Johnson, and now Maltby will clear. And again, Brian, your point, the moment the Red Wings realize they're in trouble, they dump it out.
And they make, for the most part, pretty darn good dumps, too. They don't take a lot of icing calls. They keep those seconds, precious seconds for the Winnipeg Jets, ticking away.
15,567 have been roaring their approval for the play of the Winnipeg Jets this afternoon, but they've been disappointed by the lack of goal scoring and the fact that the inability to beat Mike Bergevin could end the hockey season and the franchise life of the Jets. Kachuk will try and get something going, but his backhand pass intended for Zhamnov was blocked. Larionov turns it the other way. He had problems controlling against Newman. Now Kozlov looking for the hat trick up high on Habibulin. Zhamnov circles in his own zone, and very quickly the Red Wings move back to try and defend. Zhamnov moves it across to Newman. He'll drive it in. Korolev goes after it, but he's beaten to the puck by Kozlov. Now Manson pinches in from the point. The puck is fed out to McIver. He shoots, score!
Confused, it's Paul Coffey and Kozlov. Look at Manson all the way down in the corner. forecheck, and look at the perfect shot by McIver. Keith Tkachuk in front of Vernon, in front of the crease. And a nice pass from Korolev to McIver. McIver's got some speed, and he just drills it. Short side, but a perfect shot right up into the top corner. Norm McIver got this team back in a hockey game all of a sudden.
You had the feeling, Brian, that if Winnipeg was ever able to beat Mike Vernon, they might get one or even two and really turn this into a hockey game. It'll be interesting to follow the next few minutes.
Well, they really have aggressively gone out and really tried to generate some offense. Detroit, for the most part, has been able to shut them down. Look at McIver. Knows exactly where he wants to go with that puck. Takes a little peek before he releases the shot. And so important, the work of Keith Tkachuk in front of Mike Vernon. He pays the price. That's what buys McIver the time.
So it's a 3-1 hockey game, and the assists go to Korolev and Manson on Norm McIver's goal. First point of the postseason for Norm McIver. And we talked about the need for the Jets to be more aggressive, and it was Dave Manson pinching in from the point that forced that turnover.
And as he's done all series, Terry Simpson follows up a goal with his big banger line. Shannon, Eastwood, and Doan. He wants to maintain the momentum.
McIver was looking for Eastwood, breaking down the left wing. 11:21 remaining in the third. Here's Primo trying to throw it in front. Doan is back to pick it off. Shannon can't get it out. Lidstrom cuts it off. The Jets try again as Shannon stepped into Cicerelli and knocked him down. Cicerelli gets the return pass as he was coming late out of the zone. Then Shannon bumps into Cicerelli. The two have an exchange of words along the boards, but nothing more serious. Here's McIver working his way in, dumping it down, cut off as Coffey gets to it, and the veteran Red Wing defenseman is able to clear.
One of the things that's happening right now in this hockey game is that the Winnipeg defense are following their own dump-ins, and that in effect provides them with an extra forechecker up front.
Nevardowski moves it ahead to Janney. Janney slips it across to Muniz. Muniz with a long shoot-in. Olczyk is going after it. He gets to it. Tries to center. Tkachuk back to the net. Out front. And it skipped off the stick of Janney. Tkachuk didn't hesitate. He simply wheeled and fired the puck out into the slot. Janney was there, but the puck bounced away from him.
You know, at this stage in a hockey game, you're down by a couple of goals. It's never a bad play to flip that puck into the crease area. Certainly the Jets are due for a good bounce.
Here comes Fedorov, going hard to the net, and he just missed the far corner. Fedosov plays it back of the goal. Kozlov looks to set up, throws it into the crease, and Larionov couldn't handle it. Now it's Muniz chopping it along the boards. Oh, Tkachuk takes a big hit from Konstantinov. Konstantinov really hammered the Winnipeg captain.
Konstantinov never more than 10 feet away from Keith Tkachuk, it seems, which makes Tkachuk a little bit more vulnerable on those long clearing passes.
Now it's Yuminen for Tkachuk. Yuminen is forced to take it back in his own zone. Fired into Red Wing territory. Vernon has to play it. He leaves it in the corner for Taylor. Taylor is bumped by Zhamnov. Now Tkachuk is after Lidstrom. The puck goes behind the Red Wing net. McIver pinching in, trying to keep it onside. Lidstrom behind the net again, being pressured. Moved across for Taylor, and Taylor will dump it down the ice, and the Red Wings make a complete change.
And the fans are right back into this hockey game as well. Any little extra adrenaline they can provide to the Winnipeg Jets certainly would be a huge help.
Eastwood couldn't handle the pass at the side of the net. McIver, or Stapleton, I should say, tried to keep it in, but it was knocked past him. And Manson Johnson has to go back after it. 8:20 remaining in the third period. 3-1, the Red Wings lead. Here's Niemenen. He dumps it down. Coffey is back after it. Coffey plays it to an open wing. It bounced by Niemenen. And the veteran Winnipeg rear guard has to retreat. The Red Wings making quick line changes. Here's Eastwood now. He winds up and fires wide. Shannon goes to the corner. Bumped there by Konstantinov. Eastwood is trying to work out front. Eastwood along the boards having problems with Fedosov. Konstantinov ties up Shannon. Kozlov is bumped by Eastwood. Now Eastwood out into the slot area to the net. And Vernon is able to cover up. 7:41 remains in the third. 3-1 the Wings lead.
It's like having bargaining power right in my wallet.
My store has always had low prices, and I always have Canadian Tire money to make them even lower.
With this, I don't hunt for bargains. I make them myself.
$20?
$50?
$75 off?
It really adds up.
My dad kept his Canadian Tire money in his glove compartment.
Me? I keep mine in my pocket.
Everyday low prices. That's good.
Everyday low prices plus Canadian Tire money.
That's better.
Canadian Tire. Everyday low prices made better.
The reason that prompted me to put roll shutters on my cabin was the sense of security that I wanted to have. A number of other cabins have been broken into in my area. I was lucky enough not to be broken into, but realized it was just a matter of time. I put on roll shutters, and in fact, the following year, virtually every cabin was broken into but mine. And I think that that probably was a reason why I wasn't, that I had roll shutters on.
For security and peace of mind, call K&F Roll Shutters, 440-1934.
Kachuk, the Jets applying all kinds of pressure on the Detroit Red Wings. Furious flurry around the Red Wing goal. Look how many red jerseys are down below the hash marks here. Everybody cheating down low. Yzerman able to clear the zone eventually, but I tell you what, Winnipeg keeps throwing that puck into the crease area. Mike Vernon covers up. Look at the red jerseys. Got to figure those Winnipeg points are going to be wide open if they have enough time to control the puck.
Well, the fans have been standing almost the entire time since Norm McIver scored. Now at the point, it's Manson. Manson shoots through traffic. That is blocked, and Draper will get it, but they rule that was contacted with a high stick, and the faceoff will take place to the left of Vernon again.
You know, when Dave Manson got a hold of that puck, both Eddie Olczyk and Keith Kachuk were standing within 2 feet of the top of the crease in front of Mike Vernon. It's unfortunate for the Jets that Manson just couldn't find a seam to get that shot through.
Manson moved over to talk with McIver as Olczyk went in to take the faceoff. Olczyk will try and get it back to Manson. But Yzerman wins the draw. Lidstrom chops it along the boards. Manson trying to keep it in. He and Airy got tangled up, and the puck slides back into Winnipeg territory. A steal by McCarty. It's fired harmlessly wide. Janney starts up the ice for Winnipeg. He dodges a check. Slips it in on the left side for McIver. McIver trying to poke it to the corner. Kachuk is tied up. Lidstrom whips it around the other side. Manson pinching in again from the point, but Airy beat him to the puck. The Wings can't get it out. Finally, it's pushed ahead, and that was a glove pass by Darren McCarty. 7:03 is the time remaining in the third period.
Hi, Ben.
Oh, hi.
So, how was it today?
Good.
What did he say? Ben, what did he say?
Listen to the shore, just sit and time to see them say goodbye. I'll be home with you tomorrow, Daddy. Find all the times.
just fine.
Talk to your London Life representative about the freedom to choose and the power to get there.
Elsewhere this afternoon, it's still 5-3. The Rangers leading Montreal in the third period. And the Capitals have closed within one of Pittsburgh also in the third period. Pittsburgh and the Rangers looking to finish those two series.
The work by Bob Airey on the much bigger Dave Manson. You know that Airey will do anything in his power to try and get Dave Manson to retaliate at this stage. Good discipline shown by Manson.
Nemerdowski and Immonen are back on the points. Primo wins another draw. Faceoffs have been important this afternoon for the Red Wings. They rule a two-line pass as it was touched by Taylor.
Taylor's arguing that he never touched the puck, so why did the linesman blow the whistle? Because that faceoff will come back down into Detroit territory, but I think that linesman Randy Mitten concedes that yes, they did make a mistake, so they take the faceoff to center ice.
Primo and Zhamnoff again. And again, Primo wins the draw. Stapleton plays it off the boards for Zhamnoff. Zhamnoff chops it to the corner. Coffey races back after it. Coffey whips it around the boards, cut off by Teberdovsky. Coffey falls as he went after it in the corner. Bergevin was there, and he's successful in clearing. And Taylor is able to poke it further into Winnipeg territory. Now it's Korolev. Korolev at the line is checked. Circles to get away from the check. Leaves it there for Stapleton. Back to Zhamnoff. Zhamnoff with a neat move. Cross ice to Teberdovsky. He got tangled up with the referee, Rob Schick. Broken stick on the ice as McIver attempts to cut it off, and it slides all the way down the ice. Now it's Kozlov looking to slip it through for Fedosov. Kozlov gets it again. Teberdovsky picks it up behind his own goal.
How about Fedosov leading the charge in an offensive rush with the Wings protecting a two-goal lead with 6 minutes to go?
Well, that's something the Wings have done just about all season, and they aren't, it would appear, about to change here in game six. Larionov looks in front. The pass doesn't get through and then almost went off the skate. Olchek around the boards for Tkachuk. He couldn't handle it. Back after it is Lidstrom. He plays it off Larionov's stick into Winnipeg territory. And again, very short shift by the Red Wings.
This smart play by Scotty Bowman's troops. Again, when you're playing that dump it in, dump it out kind of style, which other than the Russian unit the Red Wings are really employing at this stage in the hockey game, it would spend a lot of energy with the Jets shortening the bench in this third period. That's an edge that Scotty Bowman will look to exploit. The amount of energy people have left at the end of a shift.
4:52 remaining in the third period. Teberdovsky falls. He pushes it ahead for Eastwood. Eastwood knocks it ahead to Doan. Coming in with Shannon. Doan trying to get around Coffey. Shannon goes back of the net with him. Doan prevented from centering it by Bergevin. The puck back of the net. Shannon trying to dig it out. Doan is into hell. They continue to battle. Finally, the puck is played off the boards and out with 4:23 remaining. Now it's Primo knocking down a shoot-in. He flips it into Winnipeg territory, and again, the Red Wings make a complete change. Newmanen's pass, blocked by Kozlov. Newmanen gets it back. Larionov is on him. He moves it across to Manson. Manson for Zhamnoff. He was checked. And the Jets have to go back with 4 minutes remaining in the third. 3-1, the Wings leading. Newmanen attempted to bank it off the boards and go after it himself. Instead, he put it into the bench out of play with 3:52 left in the third.
In the wind and the rain, I found myself. Though I was never really lost. It took me this long to realize I was looking the wrong way. Unfortunately, our eyes look out at the world, not in at ourselves. So even though at this time I find myself on this road, or at least as many roads as there are people, and through the wind and the rain, the thunder roars. I am.
Why is it that Canadian taxpayers should have to pay to clean up a mess that you made?
I'm sorry, I'm not going to talk about that.
Well, sir, excuse me. Before officials finally told him to clean up his act.
If there's something we should know about, give us a call. 1-800-ITEAM-TV.
We'd like to talk to you. We're on CBC Television.
The I-Team on the CBC Alberta News. Alberta's most experienced news team.
Well, Terry Simpson has shortened his bench in this third period, and some of his veteran players are going to be a little tired at the conclusion of this game. Manson and McCarty were tangled up along the boards for what seemed an eternity on the last shift.
Well, McCarty actually did a good job of tying up the stick of Manson and really kind of pinning him against the boards, prevented him from getting back into the play.
Chuck plays it back to McIver. He has Winnipeg's lone goal. McIver now for Jamnoff. Jamnoff fires it in. Korolev races after it. Korolev takes it back to the net. Tried to center it for Tkachuk, and it was blocked at the side of the goal by Vernon. Fedorov can't get out. McIver keeps it in. Tkachuk and Vernon collided as Tkachuk tried to go after that shoot-in. Manson at the point. Tried to keep it in, but it apparently came out across the line with 3:09 left in the third.
There are enough things in life you wait forever for. Your car shouldn't be one of them. That's why a GM Goodwrench Service Plus, your oil change is done in 29 minutes, or the next one's free. GM Goodwrench Service Plus. The plus is in the service, not the price.
Players milling about. Sergei Fedorov had some words with referee Rob Schick before Steve Yzerman came over and joined into the play. And there's a little bit of a shot by Manson. Igor Larionov, I think that's what the Red Wings are trying to point out to Schick. But what was interesting is a couple of Red Wing players jumped off the bench, and I think that Rob Schick might have called a minor penalty against them.
Well, Fedosov has gone to the penalty box. The Winnipeg bench, our penalty gate is also open, and Dave Manson is going off. They were having an exchange of words at center ice, and Schick has apparently decided to send both of them off.
Well, Manson had challenged a few of the Detroit players. Fedorov pointing at the scoreboard. Manson had challenged a few guys, and then all of a sudden, there's Fetisov. He enters your screen. It's kind of the Russian general that steps in to protect all of those talented Russian forwards.
Now, he's the oldest player on the roster of the Red Wings, 38 years of age.
I don't think this will upset Scotty Bowman, however, because Dave Manson does have that big shot back of the blue line. The good news about it, though, is the Jets do get a little more skating room with the four-on-four situation.
The Jets have to get control of the puck in the Red Wing zone, and on the shoot-in, Lidstrom was the first man there. Tverdovsky couldn't cut it off. Harry had to let it go or it would have been offside. Now Yzerman gets it for Harry. He shoots and that goes off Tverdovsky to the corner. 2:40 remaining in the hockey game. 3-1, the Red Wings lead. Here comes Tkachuk. Tkachuk coming through center, tried to work his way in. Couldn't do it. Neumannen along the boards trying to poke it free. Coffey has it. He takes his time before going rink wide, picked up there by Taylor. Taylor has Draper moving in with him. Draper with a backhand shot. A big rebound. Comes back to the line, picked up by Taylor with 2:14 remaining.
And here's where those short chips are really paying off for the Red Wings, because there's a marked edge in the jump of the legs of the Detroit forwards right now. Winnipeg, you know, with pretty much the same two lines for the entire third period. It's an exhausted group out there on the ice.
Ramsey moves it up but not out. Cut off by Craig Muni, but Ramsey gets another opportunity. Can't move it away. Olchek banks it off the boards looking for Stapleton, but a Red Wing defender, Konstantinov, got there first. 1:41 remaining. We'll keep an eye on goaltender Nikolai Abibul and whether he begins to make a move for the Winnipeg bench. Puck is knocked into Detroit territory. Vernon plays it around for Lidstrom. Lidstrom couldn't get it out. But now Paul Coffey picks it up. Coming in against Deverdovsky. Coffey, quick shot. Tried to pick up his own rebound, but it was smothered by Deverdovsky. 1:16 remaining. No sign yet that Happy Bullen is coming out. McIver gets it over to Tkachuk. Tkachuk now to Zhamnov. Zhamnov moves into the slot area. Then he lost control of it. Has to circle back to center ice, and it'll take some time for Tkachuk to vacate the zone. We're into the final minute. Now it's Zhamnov leaving it there for Deverdovsky. There goes Happy Bullen to the bench. The extra attacker out there. Lead pass played by Tkachuk down into Red Wing territory. Coffey's got it. Coffey along the boards for Ciccarelli. Over to Primo. He couldn't control it. 39 seconds remaining. Craig Janney will dump it in. Back after it goes Coffey. Coffey up along the boards. The Jets. Yuminen trying to keep it in. It's knocked away from him. Here's Ciccarelli. Can't handle the bouncing puck. Fires it wide. 25 seconds remaining. Korolev gets it to Yuminen. Takes the return pass. The Jets in their own zone. Deverdovsky loses it, and Primo puts the icing on the cake with 14.4 seconds remaining, and the Red Wings will move on to round two after a tough six-game series with the Winnipeg Jets.
Well, I tell you what, this series was an awful lot tougher than all the prognosticators suggested before the start of it. Everyone was talking about a Red Wing sweep before this series begun. You have got to admire the effort of the Winnipeg Jets in this hockey game. They gave it everything they had. I thought they played by far and away their best defensive game of the series. They came so close so many times to getting that puck past Mike Vernon. They were just unable to finish, but they never gave up. They worked all the way to the end.
And the Red Wings are about to stage the first of what they hope will be four celebrations en route to the Stanley Cup. On the other side of the ice, the final line in the obituary of the Winnipeg Jets is now written. And I think I speak for every Manitoba hockey fan when I say you'll be missed. Thanks for the memories. Well, the Red Wings came into this series heavily favored. They were picked to win the Stanley Cup after a record-breaking season of 62 victories. But the Winnipeg Jets, to their credit, facing tremendous odds, gave the Red Wings all they could handle in this series.
Got a shot of Nikolai Habibulin in particular, a rising star perhaps in the National Hockey League. Never seen a goalkeeper steal a game in the fashion that Habibulin was able to steal game five of this series. It's a tremendous effort by the Jets in this afternoon's hockey game.
Story in Winnipeg. Thanks to all there, especially the fans of Manitoba, for making it always great for us. Let's catch the final moments at Montreal.
We welcome the viewers from coast to coast for the last 1 minute of regulation time here at the Molson Center. 5-3, the Rangers. Puck is shot through, blocked. Domfus played it behind the net. The Canadiens' net is empty, and Jeff Beukelboom dumps it out into the center ice zone. Pierre Turgeon shoots it back. Here's Brian Leetch. He elects to clear it off the sideboards, and Wilkie takes over inside his own zone for Montreal. 40 seconds left, Greg Millen, here in this third period, and the Rangers stop the Canadiens at their blue line.
And the story of the series is happening right now as the Rangers are winning the battles down low all over the ice. And
and making the smart veteran plays as well. Donfus with a loose puck. Gets it back to David Wilkie. A drive off the glove of Richter in behind. 22 seconds remain. Puck loose at the side of the net. Wilkie played it around with his hand. Now Breezeball to behind the net for Donfus. Donfus trying to set up Turgeon, blocked by the defense, Buchaboom, and the Rangers clear it down. Wilkie is hustling for it. He gets to it, touches it, 4.7 seconds left. And the New York Rangers are going to advance into round two as Mike Murphy kind of pats Colin Campbell on the back. And Mario Tremblay looks on.
An example of the series, once again, Buchaboom with the puck behind the net, wins the battle because of his size and strength. And then Yari Curry for Colin Campbell makes the right play by icing it down very calmly, as you mentioned, with 4 and a bit seconds left in this series.
So the obligatory face-off, the clock ticks down. And by beating the Montreal Canadiens 5-3, the New York Rangers, we congratulate them, who came back after losing the first two games on home ice and beat the Montreal Canadiens in the next four. And as often happens in Montreal, when the Canadiens are eliminated, the fans salute both teams. Nobody's booing the home team here right now. And full value to Colin Campbell and the New York Rangers for an impressive come-from-behind victory in the series. So the final score in this, the final game of the series, the Rangers 5, Montreal 3.
Come to Edmonton's greatest compound clearance sale, featuring over 500 brand new General Motors vehicles. South Park, Pontiac, Cadillac, Buick, GMC truck, and Don Wheaton Chevrolet's Geo and Chev truck are combined at 6630 99th Street for the compound sale. 200 trucks and vans, 70 Sunfires, Cavaliers, 20 Cadillacs, 50 Buick, Olds, Regals, Cutlasses, over 100 Grand Ams, Grand Prix, Monte Carlos, and Luminous, and 40 Geo and Fireflies. One location only, 6630 99th Street.
In a world where rust never sleeps, brass locks and handle sets tarnish and discolor. Until now, introducing Wiser Brilliance, guaranteed for a lifetime.
The Formula One campaign heads for Europe as Damon Hill tries to keep his momentum rolling at Nürburgring for the Grand Prix of Europe, late night tonight.
Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC. Brought to you by Molson Canadian.
Live nationwide, this is the scene live at Winnipeg Arena. The players are just exiting now, the fans giving them, as you'd expect, a standing ovation. In some ways, although I'm sure they'd have loved the victory, it's nice that the last game in Winnipeg Jets history is in their building. This was moments ago, of course, when Keith Tkachuk wearing the C today, Teppo Numminen with the high five and the thanks for unbelievable support throughout the year. The average attendance at Winnipeg was as good as many teams in the league, and they knew all along they were bound for Phoenix. One of the great signs in the crowd was, "Phoenix, take care of our boys." And you know, Canada's gone now. There's not going to be a Canadian team. Dick Urban mentioned it on the Montreal side. We spoke of it last night. Not since 74 has the second round begun without Canadian teams. But when you look at the captains, Lindros, Sakic, Lemieux, Gretzky, Messier, Yzerman, Skrudland, all leading their teams into the round of two, you know Canada's well represented. There's a captain, Chris King, of course, unable to play today with the MCL. And Chris Chelios is the only one I didn't mention. He's an American who thinks he's from Moose Jaw, one of my all-time favorites. So a stirring moment for Manitobans and for the Winnipeg Jets. Those players will never forget that. Well, you had the chance, actually, 2 years and as many, to go through what it's like to play in the Winnipeg Arena, because the last regular season game was usually L.A.
And last year, the lockout year, Wayne Gretzky, after our game there, picked up the puck. He was a little premature in thinking that was the last game ever there.
So you got it this year? Is that what you're telling me?
No.
You know, Montreal bows out. New York Rangers got that big 4-0 lead. There was nothing they can do. When you look ahead now, as I said, look at the captains. Look at the ilk of the players that are left in the playoffs. And we're not shilling here because we've lost all the Canadian markets, heartbroken though we are. It does shape up as a nice second round.
This is a great round. What we've seen so far, unfortunately, a lot of Canadian teams, or all the Canadian teams out, but we've seen great hockey this year, and as a matter of fact, I think better playoff hockey this year than last.
Right. Stevie Y is standing by. We'll get some comments on the Red Wings surviving a tough first-round series. Let's go to Scott Oak.
Here's Detroit captain Steve Yzerman. Steve, the mission continues. What did you think of the game that won the series for you?
Well, we obviously were delighted with the first period, and they came out strong early. We were able to weather the storm, and we allowed a couple of scoring chances early, but getting those first two goals was obviously huge, and that that really put us in the driver's seat.
What would you say about the Jets, the difficult spot they were in, knowing that if they lost, they were done in Winnipeg?
Well, they're really playing with no pressure on them, and nobody expected them really to get this far, so they played really well in the series. We weren't happy that we had to come back here for a game six. You know, we played pretty well in the last game. We really didn't have any intention of coming back here, but we rebounded well. But they played a great series. You know, they really didn't have anything to lose. They worked hard, they played hard, and they forced us to really play at our best.
Steve, thanks for your time. Good luck against St. Louis.
Thank you.
So the Motor City can celebrate. Detroit's on to the next round. And thought on Montreal?
Well, even though they lost, pretty impressive year. They made a lot of changes. They have a lot of young players. You mentioned to me that they're their second youngest team in the NHL now. Thibault, Koivu, and so on. Future looks bright. You know what? I've said all along, I really like Mario Tremblay as a coach, and I think he's going to do great things with that team.
What are you going to do?
Well, I hopefully I'll make the playoffs next year, and I don't have to come back here.
You have, but your contract's up. You haven't any commitments from the Los Angeles Kings, or have you?
I think that we're going to talk, and I'll see. I'm pretty excited, as a matter of fact. This is the first time I've ever been a free agent, and there's a system in place, and I have to use it.
Good. Well, it's been a slice having you here, no doubt about that.
Thanks. Grapes is a good guy.
I mean, yeah, Grapes, except he was a little meek when Greg Medill kicked him out. He was down off the boards, and I didn't understand that. Just kidding. I got his glasses here somewhere. He wants to throw them at me. 15 seconds left, by the way, in that Pens, Caps, trailing 3-2 there. Well, you can get out your Garth Brooks anthology. We have 3 days off. There'll be no playoff action unless the Caps somehow pull it out. Doesn't look like they will. We will continue with our coverage Thursday night, coast to coast, on Molson Hockey Night in Canada. The last shots saw the New York Rangers celebrate, and of course, the Winnipeg Jets say so long. For all of us, thanks for watching today, and good day.
CBC Sports, Canada's Olympic Network.